Election 2000 coverage live on NewsCenter 43.
We're back now with our exclusive live coverage of Election 2000, hopefully winding here into the final hours of election coverage. We're only on until 2 o'clock, so hopefully we know quite a few returns by then, hopefully who our next president will be.
Thanks for staying with us throughout the evening here on channels 57 and 43. Right now we're going to go down to the Election Center where Dustin Grove is standing by with some very important results, some big developments, Dustin. Is that right?
You are right. This is as close as it gets as far as the presidential race goes. Gore has won California and Hawaii. That makes the electoral votes at 230 for Gore and 217 for Bush. Florida's 25 electoral votes are still up for grabs. And as we throw up the slides here, I believe you'll see, yeah, there you go. The electoral votes, 230 for Gore, 217 for Bush. And as we continue,
girls, let's get the math.
Can we continue, please? And for Commissioner of District 1, Stonebreaker has won. He has not won. 53% over Demery's 47%. That's with 73% reporting. Commissioner District 2, St. Meyer, 53% over Knatzer's 47%. Council at Large, Barton has 15,877, Brammer's 16,225, and Donati's 16,567. Moving along, Flowers 11,262, Robertson's 10,244, and Russell, the incumbent, 10,987. Council at Large continuing that, McShirley's 1,908 and Trapp's 2,082. Surveyor, Thornburg, 50%, just over Dickerson's 49%, that's 73% reporting. Representative District 34, Tiny Adams, 60% over Kay Whitehead's 40%, that's 45% reporting. District 35, Munson, the incumbent, 55% over Shepard's 45%, that's with 36% reporting. Representative for District 54, Saunders, the incumbent, 63% over 37% for Tutteros. For the Senate, Guard, 90% over Aaron's 10%. Guard is the incumbent. She'll keep her seat there. For Governor, Frank O'Bannon has been declared the winner, 56% over McIntosh's 42%. For Attorney General, Steve Carter has been elected the winner there. He will be the Attorney General, 54% over Karen Freeman Wilson, 44%. Superintendent of Public Schools, Sue Ellen Reed, is the winner. She'll retain her seat there, 59%. And for the Senator, Dick Lugar, the incumbent, he'll keep his seat for a fifth term, 67% over Johnson's 33. District 1, U.S. Congress, Vysklovsky has been elected another term, 73%. District 2, Mike Pence, he will replace David McIntosh, and the Republicans will retain District 2 as a senator. That's over Bob Rock's 39%. Bill Frazier also lost in that one. District 3, Tim Romer, 57% over Chocola's 43%. That's 54% of the precinct's reporting. Indiana District 4, 65% for Souter. He has been declared the winner there, 65% for him. Indiana District 6, Steve Bouyer wins it, 61% for Indiana's District 5. District 6, Dan Burton, the incumbent. He'll keep his seat, Republican, 71% over Greasy. Indiana District 7, Mr. Kearns, 65%. He has been declared the winner there. Moving on to District 8, Hostetler, 54%. He's the winner there. He is the incumbent. He'll keep his seat. District 9, Mr. Hill, the incumbent. He is the winner there, 55% over Bailey's 44%. And District 10, Julia Carson will keep her seat. She's the incumbent. She won that one, 59% over Scott's 40%. That is the latest from the Election Center. We'll continue to update you and be back with more in just a bit.
All right. Thanks for all that hard work in there, Dustin.
No problem.
All right. So lots of returns coming back. And we spoke with Ed Knatzer on the phone earlier, as well as St. Meyer. And just as they indicated, numbers are switching quite a bit. There's only a 6% margin right now. Earlier it was 10%. So it appears that Knatzer could still come back and win this.
And one of the points that we made earlier was a lot of these precincts that are coming in later on, most of the Democratic precincts, especially around the city of Muncie, came in earlier, and then the outlying precincts within Delaware County coming in later. That's why the numbers shifted heavily towards the Democratic side, looked like a Democratic landslide across the board in Delaware County at the start of the evening. And then now as we get some more of these numbers in, the Republicans start to edge back, and such is the case for Indiana House District 35, another race that we've been keeping a close eye on, was previously 51-49% in favor of incumbent Representative Bruce Munson, the Republican candidate there. Charlotte Shepard had 49%, but now that race has been updated, Munson with 55% and Shepard with 45%, again indicating that some of those more Republican districts and precincts have yet to come in and are still swinging that vote towards the Republican Party.
Still seeing lots of results coming in. Actually, we're still waiting on more states to declare their vote for president. And as you saw there with Dustin, 49-48% now is the are the numbers for Gore and Bush. Not very much at all. It's a 1% popular vote difference. Of course, Gore, though, is leading in the electoral votes. So we're still waiting on Florida to make their final decision. We're also waiting on some more of the western states, Oregon and Washington, to get in there.
Another big one that we're going to be watching is Wisconsin. Wisconsin has been a toss-up state, almost like Oregon and Washington in the way that the Nader effect has played out, a fairly liberal state, one where environmental issues are key, and thus Ralph Nader had a lot of swing in Wisconsin. And if he could have pulled enough votes away from Al Gore, then Bush could carry Wisconsin, and with a few electoral votes, could push Bush over the top. On the other hand, though, if Gore does still carry Wisconsin, and then Oregon and Washington as well, it looks like Gore will definitely walk away with this election, although we still have the issue of Florida.
It's been a crazy situation in Florida. At first, basically right after their polls closed, we saw that Florida swung toward Gore, and the electoral votes essentially went to him. Then the networks have all retracted that, and they're saying it's still a toss-up. We still don't know who exactly gets the votes from Florida, although it has not been declared a Bush victory yet, but we're still waiting to see exactly who is going to get those there. It could be a definite push over the top, that 270 votes that Gore needs to win. So should he get that in Florida, it looks like it could be a Gore victory.
And of course, those numbers, as they're pushing ever closer to that magical 270 mark, that's the number that it takes to win the presidential election in the Electoral College. I believe we have the graphic right here, and that graphic has been updated. There you see just how close it is. 230 electoral votes being declared for Al Gore. 229, just one away, is Governor George W. Bush. That is how close this race has been, and it's going to continue that way through the entire evening.
We would expect that Gore might take Arkansas, he being the vice president, or Clinton, Arkansas being Clinton's home state. But still at this point, they're still not reporting, and it's safe to assume that polls are definitely closed there. So still kind of wondering what is up in that. The same kind of situation took place in Ohio, where we had to wait quite a while to get returns from there. But it looks like Arizona, we're still waiting on Alaska, Washington, Oregon, Florida, Arkansas, Iowa, and Wisconsin. So,
and the key state right there that you see filled in on that map that we didn't have earlier is Nevada. Nevada going for Governor Bush. That is why that electoral vote total for Governor George W. Bush has pushed up closer to where Vice President Al Gore is. Again, 270 the total needed to win. If, in fact, both candidates ended up with 269 and no other candidate picks up any electoral votes based on popular vote or what have you, then things get a little trickier. We've been discussing some of these scenarios over and over throughout the evening. The House of Representatives could decide, and we could have a lot of things that don't even get decided until possibly even December, when the Electoral College actually casts their ballots.
And just as I mentioned, we had the 49-48 split among the popular vote. Still only have a one vote difference in the Electoral College, 229 to 230, I believe, if my eyes are not wearing out of me already this evening. But at this point, we're going to go ahead into a break. We'll be back in just a few minutes to continue with our live exclusive Election 2000 coverage. Stay with us.
Election 2000 coverage live on NewsCenter 43.
There you see all of our returns coming in from the Election Center. All sorts of people working hard tonight to bring you the up to the second returns. You will see those returns on the bottom of your screen on our Election 2000 ticker, and you can also see them on our website. Go to www.bsu.edu/news. There will be a link to our website, where you can look at all of the results as they come in and as we get those updated. Doing our best to get those results to you from Delaware County, also from the state races and the national races as they come in. John Shaner here with Jared Hall, continuing our live team coverage of Election 2000, going in almost into hour number six now, almost wrapping up hour number six, and it's been a long evening.
Oh, it sure has, and it appears that it's going to be even longer. Just before the break, we were talking about the presidential election and electoral votes, whatnot. There's a little story on the Associated Press wire says that Gore is quote-unquote crushed by his loss in Tennessee, as well he probably should be, his home state. But apparently Bush had enough influence there with there being a Republican governor and Republican senators and whatnot that he was able to take that state.
And one of the things that we've been talking about all evening long that's really had an effect, especially in Florida, where they've had to actually take back Al Gore's win in Florida. They had declared him the winner, given him the electoral votes. But then the networks and the Associated Press said, we were wrong, it's too close to call, and so we're still waiting on word from Florida. And one of the big reasons why this has happened is the high voter turnout.
Voters getting out to the polls, a lot of reasons for that. But reporter Josh Witzman joins us now. And Josh, you are at the county building this evening with Karen Winger at the clerk's office. They were counting all those votes for Delaware County. How was it over there?
It was kind of interesting because when we first arrived, she kind of greeted us. And the first thing, excuse me, she said was, this has been the busiest day of my life. And she was talking about how, excuse me, Delaware County, they send out 85%. They anticipate 85% of the population voting, which is an exaggeration. But some of their precincts actually ran out of ballots, and they had to send extra ballots out. So they were definitely seeing, excuse me, an influx of voters today. And the funny thing was that as the elections were coming in, more and more as the precincts were coming in, it shifted from the county races to actually the presidential race. Everyone at the county building was watching who was winning, Al Gore or George Bush, because the county elections sort of kind of have taken a back burner to that. Even though they are still important, many people in the county building are now concerned with the presidential election. But just kind of a really exciting atmosphere, because I think especially the Democratic and Republican Party teams that were present at the county building were very excited about the voter turnout. There's something that they're proud of.
Had they mentioned anything about just an increase in voter registration?
That didn't really come up. I know I visited the 8th precinct today, as I told you earlier when I did a report, and I went there about noon, and the lady that was in charge of the poll actually made the comment to me, we've had more people vote at this point than we did in the primary. And
you said you were there about noon, so just
about noon.
Four, 6 hours in the polls being open.
Yeah, so she was anticipating anywhere from 500 to 600 people voting in that precinct, and they normally only see about 200 to 250.
Wow.
So definitely almost double the number.
Doesn't sound like a lot, but in the long term, it is a lot of people. Mm-hmm.
And as we go through the process of how these votes actually come in, the people come in from each precinct, and from that point?
How it works is that at each precinct, there are two locks on the ballot box. Delaware County uses a punch card system. It's not sort of the machines that people who are in southern Indiana or other parts of the state might use. The voter simply takes a little sort of like a little point, and they punch out their choice for the office, and then it's dropped into a ballot box, which is locked with two locks. One key is a Republican key, and one key is a Democratic key. And what happens is that box is secured by both the Republican and the Democrat. It's certified by the poll marshal, and it's taken to the Delaware County building. Once it gets there, they have three machines where they unlock the box, and then the cards are fed through a machine which spits it out. And an interesting thing we noted tonight is the machines do actually have errors. I believe it was precinct 20 where we saw the fact that the precinct had to be recounted because of a machine error. So it's kind of an interesting process how it works, because I wasn't familiar with a card punch system, because where I vote in Daviess County, we use a machine. So I kind of found that interesting. But once those are processed, a printout comes out, which was given to us in the media room, listing the precinct and like how the votes came out in the precinct, and then gave us a cumulative total.
But still, even having that computer error, they can just run those right back through, and it's right. Still not very time-consuming.
There were actually three machines going at once, so three precincts can theoretically be fed through the system at one time. So it should be a very quick process. However, in the county building this evening, we did see kind of a slowness at getting started. We didn't see our first returns probably till 7 or 7:30, and that was due to the fact of the high voter turnout.
But at least that's not what happened, the Associated Press reporting, what happened in Indianapolis today. You talked about one of the precincts having to be recounted because of machine error. Associated Press reporting today that more than 100 Hoosier voters were turned away from a polling site after the inspectors failed to show up. Precincts 1 and 17 at the Municipal Gardens Community Center were not opened just because someone didn't show up. So luckily, Josh, nothing like that happened here in Delaware County, or we would have had bigger problems than just a machine error.
We were very lucky. I think that most of our errors, again, were attributed to the high voter turnout. We weren't prepared for it. We didn't expect it, but it happened. We didn't see the long lines that other counties saw, but we definitely saw more people filtering in. And I think a lot of that can be attributed to the Ball State community. Precincts that cover the Ball State community, 8, the one here on campus, they saw some people voting, where in previous times we've seen maybe 10 or 15 or, you know, just a really small number. But definitely we've seen some turnout.
At this point, let's go ahead and take a look at numbers. This is how Delaware County voted for president. There you see it. Very, very close for Delaware County. 50% of the votes going to Bush, 48 to Gore, and that again is Delaware County voters. It appears to be a little bit closer than what some of our analysts had predicted earlier in the evening. That was Dr. Steve Johnson of the Sociology Department, and he conducts the Middletown surveys. But according to his survey, he said there would be an 8%, but that was for the entire state and also at the national level. So just 2% in Delaware County, of course, not representative of the entire state.
I believe the Middletown study only actually incorporated Muncie voters. Muncie. This is in the entire county. Now, if the logic holds true with what we've seen for the other county races, more of the outlying areas vote Republican. So maybe these numbers are actually tinged a little more in the favor of George W. Bush. Perhaps within the city of Muncie, we could find that going precinct by precinct, that Al Gore actually had a better popular vote within the city of Muncie, in which case Dr. Johnson's theory about Muncie predicting the outcome of the election may be somewhat off, at least this year.
All kinds of ways that can swing. And of course, what I think they nailed it on the governor's race, I do believe. I believe he said 14%, and as of right now, that appears that there was a 14% difference in the outcome for O'Bannon and McIntosh, so it seems they nailed that one. I'm not for sure if we have all the precincts and all those numbers totaled up, but it looks like we do. So we'll see if that 8% holds up, and that has Bush winning by 8%. At this point, it doesn't. There's only about a 1% difference between Bush and Gore. So very, very close. We are probably going to be here all night with you, bringing you up to the second returns. You can make sure you watch the ticker at the bottom of your screen. We'll have returns on there. Also, join us on the web at www.bsu.edu/news. There's a link on there to our website where you can get all those returns. At this point, we're going to go head out to a break, and we'll be back in just a few minutes with more election news.
Election 2000 coverage live on NewsCenter 43.
And there you see our election center. Hey, folks, take a wave. You're working hard in there. So they're bringing up-to-the-minute results for you, keeping us updated all throughout the night, bringing you the latest in what we know. Of course, it could be a long night. We still have lots of returns to come in. So stay with us. We'll keep you up to date. And thank you for staying with us up until this point.
Of course, we've had our live team coverage, Andrea Bednar in Indianapolis. We've had Kylie Gandolf live from the Hotel Roberts in Muncie. Ben Fisher also from Democratic headquarters in Muncie. But some people that we haven't been talking to very much tonight are the people that we've had in Anderson, Christine DeJoy at Mike Pence headquarters in Anderson, and also Elliot McInnes, who joins us now. He's just back from Bob Rock headquarters in Muncie, in Anderson, rather. And Elliot, just talk a little bit about what went on.
Well, it was pretty calm at the Bob Rock headquarters. People were kind of enjoying their time, and they were really worried about the presidential race, it kind of seemed like. But at about 11 o'clock this evening, Bob Rock came and gave his concession speech. It was very short. And
guess we'll go ahead and take a look at that
okay.
Now then.
Family here in Madison County. We worked very hard on this campaign. I'm proud of the campaign that we ran. I'm proud of the support that you gave me here in Madison County. I'm proud of my county chairman, Tom Ashley, and all the hard work that you do for all the Democrats here in Madison County. And unfortunately, we came up short in my race. It was a tough race all along. We had a candidate who had very good name recognition on the other side, and he outspent us 3-1, but we never stopped fighting. One day we fought every day, fought hard, and I want to thank you for all your support, each and every one of you. I want to thank my mother for all her hard work, and my father for the good advice that I got from him, and my wife for all that she's put up with this year. And my children, who have missed out on a lot of things because Dad wasn't home to be with them. And the one good thing is Dad will be home more to be with his children, and we got another baby due on December 6th. And I just want to thank each and every one of you for all the help that you've given me. So thanks a lot.
And that is Bob Rock's concession speech to Republican Mike Pence. There you see the numbers 52% to 39%. And Elliot McInnes was there in Anderson with Bob Rock. Elliot, you said you spoke to him before and after his speech and throughout the night with returns coming in. What was his demeanor through the night? Did he feel that he had a chance to win?
Well, when I talked to him, he seemed very nervous. He told me he was nervous. He said he always is nervous with times like this. But he said he was hoping that his own county, Madison, would have had a better poll for him, as well as Delaware County. He was up in Madison. They read off the results of Madison County there at the Madison County headquarters where I was at throughout the night. And he had a pretty strong lead over Pence, but it was not strong enough. He talked about how the southern part of his district kind of took a lot away from him and supported Pence pretty heavily, and that kind of hurt him a lot.
Of course, like you said, Pence did have a lot of name recognition. He mentioned that in his concession speech. Mike Pence, of course, a radio talk show host in Indianapolis. Mike Pence also had a lot more funds at his disposal. Did Bob talk about fundraising or anything like that?
Well, afterwards, I did talk to him after his speech, and he said that the name recognition was a biggie. And he also talked about how he didn't have as much funding capabilities as Pence did and what Pence used.
The Republican Party definitely put a lot of effort into winning this race to fill the seat vacated by David McIntosh. Another thing that Jared and I have been talking about most of the evening with some of our experts is the third candidate, Bill Frazier. Mm-hmm. What impact did he seem to have? Did Rock seem to talk about him much?
Rock didn't have much to say. It didn't seem like that Frazier actually pulled that many votes at all. So, yeah, he didn't really seem like it really hurt him or helped him
obviously that margin of victory for Pence large enough that the third candidate factor really didn't come into play, it seems like.
Exactly. All right. But they were very quick to note they ran a good campaign and everything. So, all right. Well, we know our winner is Mike Pence there taking over for David McIntosh. So, all right. Thanks, Elliot, for your work tonight.
And we'll go out to a break now. When we come back, a full rundown of all of our election returns from Election Central. Stay tuned.
In East Central Indiana, there is only one place to turn for local news.
Left 2 million Serbian residents.
Boss 8 has gained national
news
attention.
Center 43.
America's top.
And Rule 7.
We're okay on time now, guys.
Clouds begin to form.
Muncie's only live TV newscast.
Reporting live only on Saturday as we go to the highlight.
An official CNN Student Bureau. News Center 43, Monday through Thursday at 5:30 and 9:30 on Burr's Channel 43. Election 2000 coverage live on NewsCenter 43.
All right, and welcome back to our live coverage tonight of Election 2000. We still have a few hours left here that we can be with you. Of course, we're still waiting on returns on the presidential campaign, also waiting on a few county races, a few state races, and we'll bring all those to you here coming up soon from the Election Center. Also, you can check those out on the ticker at the bottom of your screen, and you can also check us out on the web at www.bsu.edu/news. There is a link there right to our homepage, so you can check out all the latest returns.
And you mentioned some of those very close races. Of course, we're still waiting on Florida. We had it earlier, said that Gore was going to win the state of Florida. But now, we're still waiting. It's still up in the air. Who's going to get those 25 crucial electoral votes for the state of Florida? And so that's the big thing that we're waiting on right now. We now have reports that George Bush has won Nevada and possibly also Arizona. So we will update those totals as they come in. Of course, some of the local races have been close as well, especially the race for county surveyor. I believe that race has been incredibly close, within 1%. Richard Thornburg and James Dickerson, Thornburg the Republican incumbent in that race.
At this point, we are going to go to Election Center, and we're going to have a complete rundown of some of those numbers. Paige, are you out there?
Yeah, I'm here. Right. That's right. We're still working hard in Election Center, and we want to give you the most up-to-date numbers. We're going to start off first with the presidential numbers. We're going to take those we have right now. George W. Bush, a little bit in the lead now with 1% over Al Gore. And moving right along, we have Buchanan. He's gained 1%. Ralph Nader with 2%. And we're going to look now at the Electoral College votes. Of course, like we said, 270 needed to win. Bush right now with 237, Gore right behind with 231, like we just reported. Nevada is the one that Bush just got, and he gained 8 points for that. Now we're going to take a look at Delaware County Council, District 1. We have Stonebreaker with 53% of the votes, and we're still waiting for the result of that one. And St. Meyer is in the lead with 54%. We have 73% reporting on that one. Delaware County Council at large, we have Barton with 17,650, Brammer with 18,074, Donati with 18,430. And with the Republicans, Flowers with 11,262, Robertson 10,244, and Russell 10,987. And Delaware County Council continued. We have the Libertarians with 1908, that's McShirley, and Trapp with 20,082. For County Surveyor, it's a close race, like they said. Thornburg a little bit in the lead with 51% over Dickerson with 49, 73% reporting there. Tiny Adams with 60% of the vote. Kay Whitehead with 40% for District 34 representative. We have District 35 now. Munson in the lead with 55% over Shepherd. District 54, we have Saunders with 63% of the vote. So it's still waiting on that report there. For State Senate, we have Guard with 90%, Aaron with 10%. That's numbers stayed strong for a while now. And Indiana Governor, like we said, Frank O'Bannon is the winner, Democrat in the governor's seat now. And Indiana Attorney General winner is Steve Carter in that one with 54% of the votes. And for the Indiana Superintendent of Education, we have Sue Ellen Reed, who's our winner, with 59% of the votes. For United States Senator, like we said before, Senator Richard Lugar, the incumbent, we keep a Republican in there. District 1, we have a winner with Vislosky, Peter Vislosky, with 75% of the votes. District 2, our winner there again, like we're going to mention him again, Mike Pence with 52%. Frazier and Anderson lost with 9%. District 3, we're still waiting on that one. Romer has 58% of the votes. He's the Democrat incumbent, but we're still waiting on those numbers for the final. Winner, Mark Sauter in District 4 with 64% of the votes. District 5, winner, Steve Bouyer with 61% of the votes. District 6, Dan Burton with 71%, another winner there. Brian Kearns in District 7 with 65% of the votes. District 8, John Hostetler with 54%. He's the winner in that one. 9 is Baron Hill, who won with 55% of the votes. And District 10 finishing up with Julia Carson, who's the winner with 59% of the votes. And we wanted to let you know we're going to stay here, continuing till 2 a.m. if we need to. This is Paige Lewis live in the Election Center. Back to you.
All right. Thanks, Paige, for those returns. We'll get back to you when the need be.
One of those races that has been absolutely crucial, CNN pointed out as a key race. Congressional Quarterly marked it as a key race. Indiana House. Indiana Congressional District 8 for the United States House of Representatives, rather. That was the Evansville race contested by John Hostetler and Dr. Paul Perry, the orthopedic surgeon. And, of course, Hostetler declared the winner in that race. A big blow to the Democrats. It's something that they were really shooting for. The trend right now showing that the Republicans, instead of losing seats, which is what the Democrats were hoping for overall in the United States House of Representatives, instead of losing seats, the Republicans actually so far have gained at least 4 seats tonight. So we'll keep an eye on that and be sure to have more on that as that situation unfolds. Throughout the state, we don't have many more surprises. Most of the incumbents have won those races, and the winners right there, the party makeup as far as the as the House of Representatives, the representatives from Indiana will go. There you see Peter Vislosky, the runaway winner in that race. Mike Pence, the winner in Indiana District 2. The third party candidates coming in with a little bit of a showing. Indiana District 3, there it is, Tim Romer. Not quite declared the winner yet over Chris Chocula, but that will be close probably. Indiana District 4, Mark Sauter, the winner in that district. In Indiana District 5, Steve Bouyer, the winner in strong fashion over Greg Goodnight. And then in District 6, Dan Burton, the runaway winner there. A lot of these races almost completely in. You see 98% of the precincts reporting Brian Kearns, the winner in Indiana District 7. There you see the District 8 race. District 9 shows Baron Hill winning that one. And in District 10, Julia Carson in Metro Indianapolis taking the House District 10 seat. So you see the makeup right there. I believe it is 6 Republicans and 4 Democrats. I will have to double check my math on that.
I believe so. Mm-hmm.
And that will stay the same for the next House session. So that is very important for the Democrats and for the Republicans, something that they've been trying to avoid and something that they're going to have to live with for at least for the next couple of years.
And as John mentioned, not all of those declared yet, but it appears that it's pretty safe to say that those are the winners there. So we believe 6-4. So let's get into the county races a little bit. It appears that the council and the commissioners will all be controlled by Democrats, basically.
That's exactly what's probably going to happen. As we spoke to some of our analysts earlier tonight, we saw the Democratic Party really focusing on unity. In fact, the brochure that they sent out had Unity 2000 written on it. There you see the race for Delaware County Commissioner District 1. Stonebreaker winning that race so far, 73% of the precincts reporting. Jim St. Meyer up 54-46 over Ed Knatzer, also 73% of precincts reporting right there. As we go through the council at large, there you see the top 3 vote getters so far, all Democrats, including Tracy Barton, the former councilman, who is possibly going to retake his seat on the Delaware County Council. As we move through the rest of those candidates, there you see the Republicans trailing. Not sure whether or not they'll be able to make up such a large margin for Delaware County Council. And as we move through the rest of those seats, there you see the Libertarian candidates, not many votes for them. Moving through the rest of the Delaware County races, this is the one that we're keeping a close eye on. This is within 1%. That's actually decimals that we're down to. Delaware County Surveyor, the incumbent Republican, Thornburg, 51%, less than 51%, actually, and Dickerson with just over 49%. So that one is extremely close, and that last 27% of those precincts are going to have to decide that race.
Now, that's the one that the race that we'll definitely keep an eye on the rest of the night. Of course, we're still going to continue to watch the Knatzer and St. Meyer, Stonebreaker, Demery. Those are all also ones that could change even with that 27%. Don't really know for sure if they can come back and win those races, but who knows what could happen. We're still waiting on it. It appears some Republican precincts to report, which could give Knatzer and Demery an edge.
But still, I'm not sure whether or not their deficits are going to be overcome. Like we said, Delaware County focusing on unity. Here's the brochure itself that was sent out, Delaware County Democrat Unity 2000, which was given to many of the houses, sent out in the mail. And something else that you see here on the back, no Duke Energy plant and do not move the Delaware County Fairgrounds, something that the Democrats, especially on County Commission and County Council, have been talking about. The County Commission working on that fast and furious. They're talking about the moving the Delaware County Fairgrounds. That's been a huge campaign issue. Democrats saying don't move it. Republicans not very forthcoming with the information about whether or not they're trying to move the Delaware County Fairgrounds, saying, well, we're looking at sites, but because of the property owners, we don't want to release their names, and so we're not able to discuss freely. They've brought in outside consultants to talk about the possibility of moving a fairgrounds, and really, some people have got to be wondering, what are the people in charge trying to do with the Delaware County Fairgrounds?
And regardless of whether or not there is a decision to move or whatnot, it can't happen according to Mayor Dan Cannon, because the Lions Club does have a contract with the county, I guess you could say, on those grounds, and it can't be moved until around 2008. So regardless of what is decided, the fairgrounds are staying where they are until 2007, 2008, until that contract is up.
But still interesting to see how big of a campaign issue it has been, even though that can't be moved for another 8 years. Still something that people running for office are focusing on. And people in Delaware County really seem to be focusing on it, and they really think it's something that's important to them, Jared.
Mm-hmm, most definitely. All right, well, I guess, what do we have coming in here? Oh, that's still news that we'd already seen. Let's touch a little bit, remind people what's going on with the presidential race. We're still waiting on some big states. Florida, for one, we're still waiting. If you haven't heard already, Gore was declared the winner there. That's been retracted, and now it's still up for grabs. Hasn't been given to either of the candidates. We're still waiting on Washington State, still waiting on Oregon, maybe a few other states in there, Arkansas, maybe Wisconsin. So still things up for grabs. It looks like at this point that Bush needs 33 electoral votes to win, Gore needing 39. So it is coming down to these last few states. It looks like pretty much whoever wins Florida may take this.
Of course, it has to be remembered also that these are simply projections. Not all of the precincts are in most of these states, and these vote totals could swing. So just like what happened with Florida, if these races become too close to call, we could see some of these electoral vote totals change also. So we've got all sorts of things going on that we're going to have to consider as we go throughout the rest of the evening. And of course, we just talked about the... Are we not on 57 either? Okay, there we go. We've got the U.S. House District, District 2. We've been having some technical difficulties, but we are here with U.S. House District 2. We've been talking about that through much of the evening. We've been talking about how much money the Republican Party has channeled into this district, trying to reclaim that seat vacated by David McIntosh. Mike Pence winning that race.
That's right. I guess we'll go ahead to Christine to join now. Christine had a chance to spend some time at Pence. Did Mike Pence ever get to show up, Christine?
Yes, Mike Pence did show up. It was about 10 o'clock. It was a lot later than projected, but we were able to talk to Mike Pence, so we also do have some of his speech that we're going to show you right about now.
I guess sometimes dreams do come true.
Amen.
Karen and I are deeply humbled by the outcome of this election and by the support not only represented in this room but shown by hundreds and thousands of people across this district. A lot of people remember my last campaign have asked me what the difference was in this campaign, and I tell them that's simple. It's my faith in Jesus Christ,
Amen.
The God of second chances. He granted us not so much the victory as the grace to run a campaign of integrity. We'll give him the glory first. Second, I stand before you today not as a man elected to Congress, but we stand before you today as a family. And to my wife, Karen, and my children, Michael, and Charlotte.
And at this point, we're going to cut out of that speech. We do have a little problems with the tape. But we're going to go ahead and take a quick break, possibly. And then after that break, Christine can come back and give us a little bit of what Mike Pence had to say in his speech and answer a few more questions about that second congressional district race. We'll be back in just a few minutes.
Election 2000 coverage live on NewsCenter 43.
And we're back now. Christine DeJoy will join us right now. And Christine, you were at the Mike Pence headquarters, I guess you could say, in Anderson, correct?
Yes.
And you got a chance to speak to him about some of the issues, abortion being one of those. What did he have to say about that?
Well, definitely. He is a strong opposer against abortion, and especially partial birth abortions. And he said, in fact, one of the first things he's going to do when he gets to D.C. is to put a ban on partial birth abortions. He feels very passionately about that. And he expressed to me that he feels that with today's society that it's unacceptable. That's how he feels. And when he gets to D.C., it's going to be one of the first things that he brings up and makes a priority.
Christine, what were some of the other things that Mike Pence talked about while you were there?
Well, I had asked him, especially coming from a college-based area with Anderson University and Ball State University in District 2, how does he feel about a college tax deduction plan, or what does he believe in it? And he said that he thinks it's a great idea and that something definitely needs to be done. This way more people can afford to go to college and feel like it won't be taking out a big chunk out of their taxes. So to make it more appropriate or more accessible for more people, in general, that he believes in it, and that's also something else that he plans on working on when he gets to D.C.
Education, of course, being a big issue.
Definitely this year.
Of all the races, differing views from all sorts of ways, but sounds like an interesting thing. Of course, it'll be even more interesting to see how long it takes some of these candidates to actually get some bills enacted, get past some committees to get things going.
Definitely. And I also talked to him, too, about filling David McIntosh's spot since he vacated it to run for governor. And he said that he believes strongly in what Dave McIntosh was doing and that he plans on finishing up McIntosh's agenda and then moving on with his own. So,
Mike Pence... I've gotten the impression from him watching him in the debates, seeing him speak in public appearances, that he knew he was going to win all along. Was that the impression that you got also?
He seemed surprised that he won, but you can just tell that deep down he was very, just like, he was gratuitous that he won. He was just very happy that he won, and he just kind of wants to go on from there and not think about the past and how he thought that he was going to win. So he was just looking more towards the future, he said.
Of course, it's been a long campaign. They've had a few debates that they went through. What did he say he's going to be doing in the next few days or so? Did he mention anything?
Well, actually, I asked him, I go, what do you plan on doing before getting to D.C. and actually when you first arrive in D.C.? And he said one word, pray. So that's what he's looking forward to doing when he gets to D.C.
Probably good advice for everyone who gets elected.
Yes, exactly, everyone.
All right, thanks, Christine, for all your work out there this evening.
Thanks.
We appreciate it.
Of course, those House district races coming in, most of those have been decided now. We just received word that U.S. House District 3, the South Bend and Elkhart areas, has been decided in favor of Tim Romer, the Democratic incumbent candidate in that district.
That, of course, was one of those races. It appeared that Romer was going to win, but it wasn't really for sure for a while. Lots of districts, of course, a highly populated area up there, so lots of districts that had to be counted, probably possibly recounted, who knows. But.
And his opponent also, Chris Ciccola, a more moderate Republican in a traditionally Democratic district, that had to help his chances right there, and he had lots of financial support as well. Again, those returns are coming in fast and furious, and for more, we go to the Election Center where Dustin Grove joining us. Dustin?
That's right. We have breaking news in that presidential election. Very close. Continues to be close. Bush has just won Arkansas. That means that Bush has 246 electoral votes to Gore's 231. Now, If Bush wins Florida, this presidential race is over. 270 votes are needed to win. Again, Bush has 246 to Gore's 231. And I'm told the Wisconsin race is getting close, so we are going to keep an eye on that one. And also, many of our local races have finished. We'll have those results coming up in just a few minutes. But for now, we'll send it back to you, Jared and John.
All right, Dustin, things must be getting pretty exciting in there, waiting on those final states. It looks like we have one left that could really decide the outcome on this, Florida.
Exactly.
All right, thanks a lot for your reports. We'll check back in very soon.
Okay.
And just checked the Associated Press. Last reports had Al Gore leading in Wisconsin. Wisconsin with 11 electoral votes, a number which would definitely have helped George Bush.
Oh, yeah, most definitely. And it still will help Gore. Of course, it won't put him over the top of that 270, but will help regardless in getting up there. As we said, Bush now has 246, so those 25 in Florida would put him at 271, giving Bush the victory. So, these last final states, even though they may have smaller electoral college numbers, still could be very important in Gore's winning.
And you looked at the map back there, and the map looks almost completely yellow. But it's important to keep in mind that even though it's not the number of states that votes for George W. Bush, it's the number of electoral votes that those states have. And most of those states are the more sparsely populated states, especially out west, the Montanas, the Utahs, the Idahos, that only have 3 electoral votes each. And thus, it takes a great coalition of those states for George W. Bush to win, whereas Al Gore is keeping the race close by winning the Pennsylvanias, the Michigans, the New Yorks, and the Californias.
And possibly the Florida, so we'll see how that turns out. We're now at 10 after 12. We're in, I guess, a little over 6 hours now, and we still can be with you another hour and 50 minutes. So we'll see how things turn out in that next hour and 50 minutes. Gosh, what do we have left, John? It's coming down just to the presidents and... not much left after that. It looks like we still may be waiting for some returns from Missouri to see how that Carnahan-Ashcroft thing turns out. Last results showing that that was fairly close also.
That was very close. Obviously one of the races to watch. And another one of the races that they're watching very closely is a Senate race up in Michigan between Spence Abraham and opponent Debbie Stabenow. That represents the traditionally liberal district around the Lansing area. East Lansing is where Michigan State University is, the college town traditionally leaning Democratic. And they're hoping that Spence Abraham will win that race. He was ahead at last report, but that's another one of the key Senate races that people in Washington are keeping their eye on, and they're hoping that that will stay the way it is, and then they'll continue to hold that majority for the Republicans in both in the Senate and also in the House of Representatives. House of Representatives looking right now as if the Republicans will hold their majority.
Oh, gosh. We have all these returns coming back. We have very close races. It appears we only have a few very close races left in Indiana, or Delaware County, rather, just dealing with the commissioners. We'll get to numbers on those right after this break. We'll be back in just a few minutes with more returns and more numbers for you. Stay tuned.
Election 2000 coverage live on NewsCenter 43.
And welcome back to NewsCenter 43, our live exclusive coverage. We do want to apologize. We had a little technical problems, but we are back on 43 now. So at this point, we're going to head back out to Election Center with Dustin Grove, and he's going to give us a recap again of some of those results that are coming in. Dustin.
Late-breaking information regarding the presidential campaign. Bush has won Arkansas. That makes the electoral vote count 246 for George W. Bush and 231 for Al Gore. 242 for Al Gore. The numbers have changed because I'm told Gore has just won the state of Washington. 246 to 242 is the new electoral vote count. If Bush wins Florida, this race could be over. 270 votes are needed, so we'll continue to follow it. We also have many of the county races in, the totals in, and in a couple of minutes we'll come back and give those to you. Right now, though, we'll send it back to you.
Race a big one. Slowly, these last final states are coming in and being available to us. Right now, reports indicate that in Florida, Bush is up just 2%, so not a very big margin there at all. It could change very quickly.
I am scrolling through these numbers on our Associated Press computer right now, and what I have shows Gore, as Dustin said, leading in Washington. Obviously, they're declaring him the winner in Washington now. 11 electoral votes going in Washington. Oregon, on the other hand, 7 electoral votes, Bush leading in Oregon by a slim margin of just 1%. So that state could go either way. Obviously, Florida could go either way. And as we said a little earlier, if Bush wins Florida, it appears that the election is in his hand.
Yes, and just to point out, as John said, Oregon up 1% for Bush. The numbers here, Al Gore down 10,000 votes, so that 1% represents about 10,000 votes here. And as we had mentioned earlier with Ralph Nader, it looks like he has gotten quite a few of the votes there, over 30,000. That's 4%. So definitely that could have hurt Al Gore there. 30,000 had Gore had those votes, definitely would have had no problem, it appears, taking Oregon.
Let's talk a little bit about exactly what effect Ralph Nader has had on this election. We've seen Ralph Nader come into play in especially those Northwest states where the environment is a major issue. Washington, Oregon, also in Wisconsin where the environment is also another big issue. The Green Party appealing mostly to young people. Nader has been a very popular candidate at his rallies, the only candidate to be able to sell tickets for his rallies. That's how he's raised a lot of his campaign funds. And until Al Gore held a major rally, Ralph Nader had actually had the largest rally of any of the candidates with about 30,000 people showing up. So don't underestimate the power of Ralph Nader. He still has a lot of pull, especially among young voters and people in these swing states of Washington, Oregon, and Wisconsin. Wisconsin right now, though, leaning towards Al Gore. Nader not having too much of effect right now. What happened in the last couple weeks of the election, Jared, was Al Gore begging Ralph Nader not to take votes away from him.
Basically, and that's what it seems like some of these candidates, maybe they're running in the election because they don't want to see a specific person win or whatnot. But it's also also kind of hard even to compare Nader to Ross Perot, who a few years back was our third-party candidate. Doesn't even seem like he had this much effect on the election.
Well, that's very true, because in 1992 and then again in 1996, the margin wasn't as close as it is this year. This, of course, being the closest vote for president in the last 40 years since Nixon and Kennedy back in 1960. But Ralph Nader having such a profound influence, and the supporters of Nader, although some of them were convinced by Al Gore saying a vote for Nader is the same as a vote for Bush, trying to get him, get those Nader supporters to vote for Gore instead of Nader, saying that Bush is merely a puppet of big oil and of big business, things that Ralph Nader, those issues that Ralph Nader is definitely against, trying to keep big business out of politics, trying to keep big business out of the lives of the American citizens. Ralph Nader, obviously, some of those people, Ralph Nader stood up to Al Gore saying, we don't want to buy any of that. If Al Gore had run a better race, he wouldn't be in the position where we had to give up our votes to give votes back to Al Gore. And so it'll depend on whether or not those voters who are going to vote for Nader stick with him as a vote of protest against the two-party system, or whether they actually concede to Al Gore and say, look, we're not going to win this election as the Green Party. We're going to give our vote to the person who coincides most with our beliefs, and that would be Al Gore.
And what's interesting, you mentioned the Green Party. All of our third parties up until this point had basically the Reform Party, of course, kind of spearheaded by Ross Perot, and the Libertarians, the Independents, but it's just out of the blue, this Green Party, hits the headlines, and it's just, where'd this come from? So,
well, they've been around for a long time. They just haven't seen the support that they've been seeing in this last election cycle. Ralph Nader, obviously throwing his support behind the Green Party, it's been vital in giving the Green Party that total. And Ralph Nader hoping that he can get the 5% of the total popular vote that he needs to secure federal funding for the Green Party. And so that's what Nader's looking out for. The rest of the country, whether or not he actually gets those 5%, doesn't look like it at this point. Some of those West Coast states still have yet to have some of their votes counted yet, but the popular vote right now shows Nader not quite getting 5%, and so whether or not this election was actually a bust for Nader or whether he was going to be able to succeed in getting that 5% and getting federal funds for his Green Party still remains to be seen. We'll have to watch out for that as the night progresses, and probably not even until later tomorrow and then the days following will we actually find out the actual vote totals for all of these different parties.
Something also interesting here on the Associated Press wire, a little comparison between Gore and Bush. Gore has 48% of the popular vote compared to Bush's 49%, but Gore's 48% represents 16 states that he's won. Bush's 49% is 28 states, so that is a 12-state difference, but only a 1% difference here in the polls. It's almost amazing. It actually looks like about 700,000 vote difference between Gore and Bush.
And this could turn out to be a repeat of 1960, where it turned out to be one vote per 100,000 precincts across the country, where one vote in each precinct turned the tables for Kennedy over Richard Nixon. We could have heard, "I am not a crook," maybe a few years before if Nixon had been voted in 1960.
Absolutely, and it looks like it could also be a repeat of 1888, where we have one candidate winning the popular vote, one candidate winning the Electoral College. And of course, there's always a lot of talk about the Electoral College and the popular vote system, whether or not the Electoral College should be done away with, because you know, how representative really is it of the popular vote? Should it be based on how many votes the candidate actually receives? 35 million votes that Al Gore has received. That is a lot of votes. That's a huge number. Although not in comparison of how many people actually are registered and live in the United States, but still 35 million is a lot of people.
And that was one of the big debates when forming the Constitution, trying to find out how this election system was going to work. A lot of the smaller states wanted their voices heard. They said we should use this Electoral College system in order to give us better representation. Those smaller states getting at least three electoral votes. The bigger states said, you know, we don't care about those smaller states. We want our people to have the power. Just use the popular vote. And so obviously it's still a debate that's still going on today. Maybe not in 1888 when it was Benjamin Harrison and Grover Cleveland. They just kind of accepted the system as it was. But if this actually turns out the way that it could turn out tonight, with Al Gore winning the Electoral College vote and George W. Bush winning the popular vote, we could see a lot of voices saying, hey, we don't like this system, and we want it changed so that the right guy gets in office.
Absolutely. Well, as we wait for those final elections numbers to come in on the presidential race, we're going to take a break. And after the break, Kylie Gandolf will join us. She's back in the studio from Republican headquarters. That'll be coming up pretty soon. Stay with us.
Election 2000 coverage live on NewsCenter 43.
And we're back now with more live exclusive coverage of Election 2000. New update for you. We are on now until 3 o'clock if we have to be. We've extended our coverage time because we're waiting on these results from Florida and actually final results even in some of the county races. So at this point, we're going to turn it over to Election Center with Paige Lewis. She has some more updates for us. Hello, Paige.
Hi there. That's right. We'll be here till 3. But for now, we're going to go ahead and just give you some county results. And we're going to start out with Delaware County, County District 1. We have Jack Stonebreaker is the winner in that county, and we see right there he won with 53% of the votes. We're going to move on to Delaware County District 2. The commissioner here, we have a winner. It is St. Meyer for District 2. And County Council at Large, we now can report we have winners there. All the winners are the Democrats. We have Donati with 19658, Brammer 19188, and Barton 18774, and that's we're reporting that all three Delaware County Council members at large are going to be Democrats. There you can see the Republicans, and Mick Shirley and Trapp ended up with 3033 and Trapp with 3284. And we're going to go ahead and move on to Surveyor. We have a winner now, Richard Thornburg. It was a close race. He won there with 51%. And that's all we have right now. But we're going to send it back to you there in the studio. Back to you, John and Jared.
All right. Thanks a lot, Paige. We will, I'm sure, be checking back with you once we get some more presidential numbers. All right, so there you have it. We have declared some winners here in Delaware County. Stonebreaker and St. Meyer, both Democrats, are the new county commissioners. We also have a sweep by the Democrats on the county council. Donati, Brammer, and Barton are the three Democratic council members for the county.
A clean sweep for the Democrats here. We talked about this a little earlier. It's something that we were sort of looking at the beginning of the evening. The numbers started to tighten up as some of those more Republican precincts started to come in. But still, those margins were not quite small enough for those Republicans to overcome them. And of course, the other county commissioner being a Democrat in district number 3, we'll see all three county commissioners as Democrats and all three county councilmen as Democrats. The one salvation for the Republican Party in Delaware County so far tonight was incumbent Richard Thornburg winning the race as Delaware County Surveyor.
Mm-hmm. Very close race there, 51-49%. You saw the numbers. Very close race all throughout the evening. We really didn't see much of a big gap in the numbers, not really at any point. So close throughout the evening, we have a winner now, Thornburg with 51%. And I guess we should also stick along the lines with some of the local races. Kylie Ganoff, we heard from her earlier downtown at Hotel Roberts. She spoke with Knatzer and some of the other Republicans there. She joins us now. Welcome back, Kylie. Great job there tonight. What was the mood there?
Well, actually, we left after just about everyone had left. I don't even think when we left there were any candidates running.
Kylie, we'll ask you to put a microphone on here. Neglected to put a microphone on. So we'll get Kylie microphoned up there, and we'll get back to her in just a couple of minutes. It's been a long
night
here
so that's
for us.
Okay.
We are going, getting ready to go into hour number 8 in about 25 more minutes. It's hard for us to believe as well. Things are shaping up to be an even longer night as we've extended our coverage until 3 o'clock to get you the races you need to know, up to the second results for the county races as well as the state and national races. Okay, now
Kylie's ready.
You have your microphone on.
Sorry about that.
What
like
was
you said, it's
tonight?
Been a long night. Well, like I said, when we left, just about all the candidates were gone. The mood, I expected it because the candidates, for the most part, were pretty far behind. And I expected it to be kind of a more somber mood, but it wasn't at all. I mean, everyone was still up, and you could just tell they were waiting until that last minute. I mean, it wasn't over till it was over for them. They were waiting till that final vote came in to make sure that they lost. I mean, up to the very end, they were still hoping for a win.
And Knatzer, when you spoke to him, really thought that some of those outer-lying Republican precincts could pull through. They didn't, unfortunate for him. But,
right.
So.
And he also said that he didn't think the property situation, the save-a-lot. Right. He didn't think that was affecting the race at all. So, I mean, he was very confident with that. So.
Did he have anything to attribute his loss to?
No, not really. I think, and I even mentioned, you know, you're an incumbent, and typically people think that incumbents, they're more likely to win a race. And, you know, what kind of challenges does he face? And he just says that, you know, that's just a big myth, that incumbents have it just as hard as people coming in fresh. But I did talk to McIntosh a lot, and I'd like to talk about McIntosh for a little bit. I talked to him actually as he was walking out of the hotel as he was leaving, and we just sort of ran into each other, and he said that he was just really happy to be able to stay in Muncie the whole night and spend time with his friends and family rather than having to go to Indianapolis. He also made a direct reference to us, and he said that he was thrilled to be able to talk to us since we were a local station, and he knew that only local people would be seeing us. I asked him what he would be doing tomorrow. He said he would sleep in, wake up, kiss Ruthie, and play with Ellie all day long. So he has some well-deserved time off now, of course.
Much-deserved rest that he has coming to him.
And also, in reference to his concession speech, I just think it must be incredibly hard for campaign workers. They campaigned for 18 months hard. And he thanked them during his concession speak for the hard work and dedication that they gave. He also called O'Bannon before he gave his concession speech and to congratulate him. And he said himself that he thinks O'Bannon is a good man and that he'll do a good job. He did say in his concession speech that he will do it again, referring to the political world. He didn't specify what he would be running for or what that implied. I asked him after the concession speech directly, will we see you on the governor's ballot in 2004? To which he sort of beat around the bush. He said, you never know what might happen, but judging by the smile on his face, I would not be surprised if he was on the governor's ballot in 2004, because he just had a really big smile on his face at that point, so I wouldn't be surprised at all to see him on the ballot.
That's a lot of our political analysts this evening said you can't count David McIntosh out because there could be lots of seats opening up, especially with Lugar retiring possibly here at the end of this term that he's just been elected to, this being his fifth term, so who knows, McIntosh may consider that. Mm-hmm.
And, of course, you did get a chance to talk to David McIntosh tonight. And here are some of the things that McIntosh had to say during this evening.
I think we had the right vision. We focused on critical problems that are looming ahead. The taxes are going up with reassessment. We've got to improve our schools. We have to create more high-tech jobs for the future. But I think people were saying, well, that's not an immediate problem. And so maybe we'll stick with the incumbent governor and see what he does when those problems come up. And that's their choice. I'm willing as a private citizen to help in any way I can, any way the governor asks me to.
Will we see you on the governor's ballot in 2004?
Yeah, I don't know. You know, you never say never to things like that, but it's much too early to think about something like that.
Also, that first question I asked him that he was responding to, I was referring to the 25% property tax cut. I asked him if he felt like maybe Indiana never quite picked up on that because it didn't quite get the attention he was hoping for. And so his answer to that, of course, was he just doesn't think Indiana was ready for it. And they were more concerned about some other issues other than the property tax cut. So
it's a big issue to consider lots of different alternatives with that. It looks like, though, McIntosh gave it his best shot. Of course, running up against incumbent mm-hmm. Governor O'Bannon in a tough race. And who knows, we may see him again.
Right. I asked him if he he looked at his campaign as a whole, if there were one or two issues or one or two things that he think he could credit his loss to, what would they be? And he said that it's not what he did to lose, but what O'Bannon did to win. So he just realizes that O'Bannon, obviously, he says, ran the better race than him. So
any issues in particular that he thought?
No, he didn't refer to anything specific. He just said that he thinks O'Bannon ran a better race, and he didn't really specify. So
well, so now McIntosh has learned he knows what he needs to do mm-hmm. Coming up in the future.
Yeah, wouldn't future be surprised elections. At all to see him in our future political world. Not a bit surprised.
Mm-hmm. A lot of options for him. If Bush wins, he could go to Washington. He mm-hmm. could serve as senator or secretary of state, mm-hmm. possibly, in the state of Indiana. So, Kylie, thank you very much for all the work you've done tonight. And I'm sure it was interesting to go see David McIntosh
as
well.
All right, thanks, Kylie. Thanks again.
Well, we're going to take a break right now, I believe. When we come back, we'll have Mike Pence's acceptance speech once again, his victory speech from Christine DeJoy. Stay tuned. More of Election 2000 coverage on NewsCenter 43.
In East Central Indiana, there is only one place to turn for local news.
About 2 million Serbian residents.
State has gained national
News
attention.
NewsCenter 43.
America's
and Rule 7.
We're okay on time now, guys.
Clouds begin to fall.
Once he's only live TV newscast.
Reporting live.
Only live.
On Saturday as we go to the highlights.
An official CNN Student Bureau. NewsCenter 43, Monday through Thursday at 5:30 and 9:30 on Burr's Channel 43. Election 2000 coverage live on NewsCenter 43.
And there you see it. It's Election Center. Take away, folks. You've been working hard tonight. Hello out there. Are you still alive?
They can't hear you, Jared. Sorry.
Oh, okay. Well, they're just working furiously trying to get in those final returns. We're waiting on Florida and possibly one or two other states. But we're just going to come back in here to the studio now, and Christine DeJoy was in earlier. She was at Mike Pence headquarters for that race, and we had his acceptance speech, had a little problems with it, but we're coming back to that now, the Pence.
Yes, definitely. We're going to show the Mike Pence acceptance speech right now. We apologize for the technical difficulties before, but everything should be worked out now.
I guess sometimes dreams do come true.
Amen.
Karen and I are deeply humbled by the outcome of this election and by the support not only represented in this room, but shown by hundreds and thousands of people across this district. A lot of people remember my last campaign. They've asked me what the difference was in this campaign. And I tell them that's simple. It's my faith in Jesus Christ, the God of second chances. He granted us not so much the victory as the grace to run a campaign of integrity. We'll give him the glory first. Second, I stand before you today not as a man elected to Congress, but we stand before you today as a family. And to my wife Karen and my children Michael and Charlotte and Audrey, I dedicate this victory. In fact, we dedicate this victory to the families of East Central Indiana, to the family of David and Ruthie McIntosh, on whose broad shoulders we stand tonight, our heartfelt thanks. future beckons. David McIntosh and the Pence family is ready to go to work as soon as he chooses which future that is. To our competitors and their families, we thank you for your decency and your civility on the campaign trail. We honor the service to your country which your candidacy represents. To the families that supported us with their volunteer time, talent, and treasure, would that we could name you all, but know that you're in our hearts tonight. To those who voted for us, our thanks to you will come not so much in what we say as what we do. We pledge to serve with integrity and advance the cause for which you are sending us to Washington, D.C., to renew the American dream.
And Mike Pence and Republicans are obviously happy about his win.
Definitely. In fact, I had an opportunity to talk with Mike Pence for a while, and one of the questions I asked him was what he plans on doing, because he mentioned David McIntosh in his speech, now that he has taken over his seat in the House. And he says that he has a lot of respect for McIntosh, and in fact that they become very good friends, and that he plans on going with McIntosh's agenda, finishing out his agenda, and then when he's done with what McIntosh had planned, he'll go on from there with his own.
And Pence had been talking a lot about education, lot about things of that nature, and a lot of conservative social issues as well.
Correct. One of the things you mentioned, education, I asked him, especially with District 2 having two universities, Anderson University and right here Ball State University, what he was going to do about the issue of college tuition being tax deductible. And he said that he believes that the college tuition should be tax deductible. It would allow more people to go to college, be able to afford it, and that he thinks it's a great thing. And it's going to be one of the things that he plans on working on when he heads out to D.C.
All right. Well, I'm sure District 2 is looking forward to having him still taking that seat and working for us in D.C.
Definitely.
All right. Thanks, Racine, for all your work out there tonight.
And we will take a look now at some of the Indiana House and Senate district seats. Some of these results now are becoming final. In District 33, Ron Liggett, Northeast Delaware County, winning that race with 54%. Ron Liggett, the incumbent there. In House Seat 34, District 34, Representative Tiny Adams, the incumbent Democrat, winning with 60% of the vote over Kay Whitehead. Indiana House District 35, Northwest Delaware County, Bruce Munson winning that race with 57% of the vote over Charlotte Shepard with 43% of the vote. And in House District 54, Extreme Southern Delaware County, that would be Thomas Saunders winning with 65% of the vote right there. We've got a lot of returns coming in. And for more of those numbers, we go to the Election Center where I believe Paige Lewis is standing by. Paige?
Hi, Paige.
That's right. Hi there. Yes, we have a lot of returns to look over. We're going to start out with the presidential election. As you just saw, George W. Bush is in the lead. He has 49% right there. Gore trailing with 1% right behind him. And Buchanan and Nader 1 and 2%. Looking at our electoral votes here, 246 for Bush, 242 for Gore. Still waiting for that big Florida state with 25 electoral votes. Right now for District Delaware County District 1 Commissioner, we have that winner, Jack Stonebreaker, with 53%. St. Meyer winning in District 2 with 53%. And for the county council at large, like we said before, Democrats winning it all the way through, Barton, Brammer, and Donati. As you can see, there are the Republicans trailing with not too many behind. And the Libertarians, McShirley and Trapp, are the last two reporting in that one. Now for Surveyor, like we said, Richard Thornburg is the winner, the Republican winner, with 51% over Dickerson. District 34, we have a winner now, Tiny Adams, winning with 60% of the votes over Republican Kay Whitehead. District 35, another winner, Republican Munson, winning with 57% of those votes over Shepard with 43%. District 54, another winner, Saunders, another Republican, with 65% of those votes. Moving on to State Senate, 89% to 11 with Aaron. We still are waiting for that one with 91% reporting, so we'll have to wait a little bit longer on that one. Indiana Governor, like we said, Frank O'Bannon, the Democrat, is the big winner tonight with 56% of the votes. Indiana Attorney General, winner, like we said, Steve Carter, 54% of the votes over Freeman Wilson with 44%. And for the Indiana Superintendent of Education, the winner, Sue Ellen Reed, the incumbent Republican with 59% of the votes. U.S. Senator Richard Lugar, big winner tonight again, 67% of the votes over Johnson with 32%. And Peter Vislowski with 74% in Indiana District 1. District 2, our big district here, we have Republican Mike Pence, the winner, over Democrat Bob Rock with 39% of the votes. Frazier and Anderson each finishing up with 9%. District 3, like we said, we're still waiting on that one. Romer's in the lead with 52% of the votes. We're just waiting for the final announcement on that one. District 4, like we said, Mark Souter, the winner, with 63%. District 5, Steve Bowyer, the big winner there, 61% of the votes. District 6, Dan Burton with 71% over Greasy with 27% of the votes. District 7, Brian Kearns is the winner, Republican there, with 65% of the votes. District 8, John Hostetler, 53% over Perry. District 9, we have Barron Hill, the Democrat incumbent, winning that one with 55% of the votes. And District 10, Julia Carson, with 59% of the votes in that one. And, of course, we're going to continue to give you live coverage here from the Election Center. We have everyone working quickly to get those numbers to you. We're still waiting on District 3, of course, and the big presidential election. And we'll throw it back to you, John and Jared.
All right. Thanks, Paige. We will get back to you very soon once more numbers are available. And we should mention, like Paige said, we're waiting on, it appears, four states to determine the president. Florida, Iowa, Wisconsin, and Oregon will be the big determining factors there. And then as far as Indiana goes, that third congressional seat between Romer and Chicola, 52 to 48%. We're just waiting on, an official declaration of the winner there. But it appears that we have the winner is Romer. Again, there you see the map for the presidential race. Should George W. Bush take Florida, he would win this election. But mathematically, Gore, should he take Florida, would still need another state to win. So it's basically all up to Florida what they decide down there. Last indications, last results that we had have Bush up 2%. But who knows, things could change. Initial indications had Gore winning. That's what we and the networks had all reported, but the AP and networks all retracted that statement, and so it's up for grabs once again.
And, of course, all of these numbers that we have right now, declaring the winners for all of these states, these are not complete totals. Right. Some of the East Coast states did come in very early today, and some of the West Coast states are coming in a lot later. Now, you see that Florida is still up for grabs, Wisconsin's still up for grabs, Iowa and Oregon are the ones that we're waiting on. Now, we need to do a little math here. With those 246 electoral votes, Oregon with seven electoral votes, plus Wisconsin, which has 11 electoral votes, that's 18 right there. That would give Bush up to 264. And then it's unclear whether or not, depending on how many electoral votes Iowa has, I have not memorized all these totals, but I'll get those for you. But definitely, Iowa has seven electoral votes, we've just found out. So that would then be equivalent to the 25, which he would get from Florida. And thus, if Bush were to win all three of those northern states, he would also win the election. So Gore really needing to win at least two of these states to become president.
It's coming right down to the wire. Things are getting exciting here. Coming up right to the last minute, who knows what's going to happen in these final hours here. We are into the new day. It's actually not even election day anymore, I guess you could say. We're now on November 8th. Going on 1 o'clock in the morning. We'll be with you until 3 o'clock if the need be. And
around 1 o'clock, a lot of these numbers get updated by the Associated Press. As soon as those numbers get updated, we will have them for you. We'll have them on the Election 2000 ticker at the bottom of your screen, as well as on our website, www.bsu.edu/news. There's a link right there. Click over it, and you'll get onto our website. And watching those last four states, we'll have the results for you as long as we need to on NewsCenter's Election 2000 coverage, live team coverage all night long, bringing you the latest returns, trying to find out who will be the next president of the United States. Stay tuned. We will.
Election 2000 coverage live on NewsCenter 43.
We're back with more of our live team coverage of Election 2000. John Shaner along with Jared Hall, and we've got people all over the place. We've had people in Muncie at the Republican headquarters at the Hotel Roberts. Kylie Gandolf was there. She's back. Ben Fisher was at Democratic headquarters tonight. We've had people in Anderson who have been back. And we've also had people live from the Election Center and also Josh Witzman at the County Building bringing you all of the latest returns, up to the second returns on all of the races that matter to voters in Delaware County.
That's right. We have almost everyone back in studio now as those headquarters have pretty much shut down for the evening, those places that know who the winners are. And actually right now, Andrea Bednar, she's back from Indianapolis. Andrea, thank you for your reports via cell phone.
Oh, no problem.
How was the mood down there in Indianapolis with O'Bannon?
Actually, the mood was, it was very festive, it was very exciting, upbeat, lively, people were excited, they were very confident that O'Bannon was going to bring a victory tonight, so that was really not much of a surprise. There was a live band was playing called Running with Scissors. They were all actually Democrats, and some of them were attorneys that were doing it free of charge. They were just there volunteering because they wanted to help out with everybody. It was really, it was a fun evening.
And, of course, you did have Governor O'Bannon winning re-election rather handily. Was never really in doubt that he would win. That was announced actually right after 6 o'clock, right after we went on the air, that O'Bannon had won the re-election as governor. But the surprise of tonight had to have been the Indiana Attorney General seat with Steve Carter being beating Karen Freeman Wilson. What was the atmosphere about that? Were people surprised?
You know, she really wasn't brought up that much during the time that we were there because she did not show up during the time that we were waiting. As a matter of fact, I just heard reports that she wasn't even hasn't even arrived yet, and they've since cleaned up headquarters, cleaned up the entire ballroom, so she never did make an appearance, but supposedly she hasn't conceded victory officially yet.
Actually, while you were on your way back, did have the speech from Karen Freeman Wilson that conceded victory to Steve
Carter. At the time when we were there, she wasn't really mentioned that much. There was so much hype about O'Bannon winning re-election that she wasn't really much of an issue, but there was a lot of support there for David Johnson, who did give his concession speech.
For a lot of the local races, a lot of our reporters have been coming back saying these races weren't even really that much paid attention to. Everyone was watching the presidential race. How were things in Indy?
Actually, they had monitors up that a lot of the supporters and the ralliers were watching, and people were just, you know, they were cheering a lot when, obviously, there was a lot of Democrat supporters there. Every time Gore won a state, people were cheering. That was really the issue of the night, as you said. People were more concerned about that. They pretty much knew what was going to happen in the Indiana races as far as what went on tonight.
Any indication there who do they think Gore is going to end up pulling out a victory? Because at this point, who knows?
You know, it was split pretty much 50-50. You had people saying that they think Gore had it, and you had people saying that they think Bush pulled it out. So it's really anybody's guess.
It seemed like the support was very much consolidated in that one area down where you were. We saw O'Bannon's speech, and we also saw Karen Freeman Wilson's speech. One thing that we talked about was the possibility of Joe Kernan running for governor in 2004. Did you hear any indications that maybe he was being prepared, pushed into the spotlight for a possible run at that?
There wasn't anyone really mentioning Kernan running for that position, but I can tell you when he did approach the stage, when his name was ever mentioned, the entire place just erupted in applause. People just went absolutely crazy.
Apparently the Democratic Party loves Kernan.
Much support for Kernan, much support.
All right.
Of course, the Democrat from South Bend, Joe Kernan, Lieutenant Governor right now. And of course, probably one of the highlights of the evening down there in Indianapolis had to have been Governor O'Bannon's victory speech. I believe we do have that, and we'll take a look at that right now.
Thank you. Thank you very much. It can be better. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. And to top it all off on this election day, to be here with so many friends and so many people that we need to thank for this great win. And it's mainly thanking you for being a part of what we're trying to do. And I want to thank all the people in the state of Indiana that have said that we're moving in the right direction. We want to continue to move in the right direction, and we'll do that. As we said 4 years ago, there's things that need to be done in the state of Indiana to build it up. We talked about changing direction in public school education, and we've done that, and we've got a lot more to do, and it's exciting to do that. And we look at the next 4 years to make sure the new community college system is all over the state of Indiana, can help people. And we've been able to put 500 police on the street, cut property. Yeah. Cut taxes $1.5 billion and make sure. And put the state on a sound fiscal basis that says that if there's a downturn, we don't have to raise taxes. We will look forward to the future. And we have the highest credit rating the state's ever had that says this is a place to do business, this is a place to work, this is a place to live. The state is Indiana. All right, we're going to do it. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. I did get a call from my opponent, Congressman David McIntosh. He is very gracious. Judy and I certainly wish the Congressman and Ruthie and L.A. the best. And we look forward to continuing the progress here in the state of Indiana. I want to thank my partner, running partner, Joe Kernan. He's fabulous. He's done everything we've done. And a great deal of thanks to Tom New and Robin Winston and all the others. But it's all of you here tonight, people all over this state, that believe that we do put Hoosier families first and will continue to put Hoosier families first. But it's a remarkable, remarkable year. And we're glad it's come to a victory here on this night. John. When we put families first, that's certainly what Judy and I consider with our whole family that's here. Our children, our grandchildren, sister, nieces, nephews, a big part of our life. But tonight was also another special thing happened. Got a card from my son and daughter-in-law, and it said, "Grandchildren are those precious little miracles that bless our lives and fill our hearts with love." And inside, they announced there's going to be another grandchild, Baby O'Bannon, coming up. So, so the future always looks great for new things and new people and new places to go and see, and there's no better place in the state of Indiana than the state of Indiana to be here and do those things to make it a great place to live. Thank you all very much. Thank you.
You saw Governor Frank O'Bannon's acceptance speech around a little after 9 o'clock this evening in Indianapolis. Andrea Bednar was there for that. And good news they had, not only winning the election, but about having a new grandbaby. So congratulations to them on that front. Andrea, what did O'Bannon say his priorities are for the next 4 years? Of course, he can only have 4 more years in office as governor, so what are his priorities?
That's correct. He can only have 4 more years in office. The main thing that he emphasized was he wanted to continue Indiana moving in the right direction. He emphasized prosperity that the state has achieved, and he wants to keep everything obviously going in that direction. He really was proud of the community college system that he's established throughout Indiana, as well as getting the 500, as you heard in the speech, the 500 police officers on the street. When I spoke with O'Bannon, I asked him about the negative campaigning that was taking place between he and his opponent, and he basically said that they were attempting to respond as favorably as they could. They didn't want it to be a negative campaign, but things don't always work out that way. But overall, he's just looking at it being a positive 4 years in the future.
All right. Sounds good from the O'Bannon campaign then. And of course, who knows, we may have Joe Kernan appearing more in the next 4 years, trying to get his name even higher in the spotlight for a possible run at the governor's seat in 4 years.
We may see that. And if it's any indication of the amount of support he had at the convention center tonight, then it should
be a
good
showing. All right. Well, thanks a lot for all your work tonight, Andrew. We appreciate that.
You're welcome.
All right. Thank you, Andrea. We want to get you up to date. Some of the latest numbers from across the nation have come in via the Associated Press wire. Starting off with the most important state, Florida. We'll get to those numbers up after a break. We'll take a break and then get you up to date on all of the latest numbers from around the country. Presidential race still up for grabs. More in a minute on NewsCenter 43's election.
Election 2000 coverage live on NewsCenter 43.
And we are back now. It is now after 1 o'clock in the morning, and we still have it about 2 more hours that we can still be on with you until 3 o'clock in the morning. Of course, we are still waiting on results from 4 more states in the presidential election. It looks like we have everything else declared except for the presidential race. Of course, probably the most important race of all that we are really covering this evening, because it is so close. It has been close ever since, just about a couple weeks ago, and once things started evening out after the national conventions took place. Right now, we have Florida, Iowa, and Wisconsin, and Oregon all very close. John, you have some numbers there?
Yes, we do. And actually, it looks like a lot of the votes are very close to being counted. It looks like we are almost set to announce a winner in Florida and Iowa. In Florida, 91% of the votes have been counted. Bush there leads by 2% in the polls. Again, if Bush does win Florida, that puts him over the magic 270 mark. It would give him 271 electoral votes, and thus Bush would win the presidential election. In Iowa, however, Gore is ahead by 1%. 7 electoral votes up for grabs in Iowa, 92% of the precincts reporting in Iowa. In Wisconsin and Oregon, the numbers are a little bit farther behind. Wisconsin, 11 electoral votes, 73% of the votes counted. That race is virtually a dead heat. This is about as close as you can get. Right now, Al Gore leads by about 6,000 votes. When you consider that 1% in Oregon was about 10,000 votes, the fact that Gore is leading by only about 6,000 votes makes that Wisconsin race by a long shot too close to call. In Oregon, as we mentioned, 71% of the votes have been counted. 7 electoral votes up for grabs. Bush leads Oregon by 3%. Again, here are the possibilities. Bush could, in order for Bush to win, he could win Florida, which he could do being up by 2%. Or he could win the other 3 states, Iowa, Wisconsin, and Oregon. Gore does lead in 2 of those 3 states, so it looks like Bush would need Florida in order to pull out a victory tonight. But with 91% of the votes counted in Florida, it looks like we could have those results a little earlier than we thought.
With 91% reporting, looks like it could be close. Still kind of interesting surprise tonight. with Gore initially being announced as the winner in Florida, it's almost a good thing that that announcement was retracted, because it appears that Bush may take Florida and get those 25 to put him over the 270. So quite a surprise, an extreme change of events this evening that we've seen in the presidential race.
And one of the main reasons, we've been talking about it all night, one of the reasons that this Florida retraction had to come out, and also some of the things that have been delaying numbers here in Delaware County, is voter turnout. Voter turnout, we've seen delays at the polls. We've seen voter turnout extremely high. That wasn't expected, but because of the closeness of this race, that's something that did come to pass. Although we have seen in the past couple of elections, that student numbers, as far as college students and young people ages 18 to 24 voting, we haven't seen them going out to the polls very much. I took a look into some of the reasons why young people don't vote, and what professionals have to say about it.
If you don't vote, don't complain.
As mayor of Muncie, Indiana, Dan Cannon hears plenty of complaints.
When people complain to me about certain issues, I always ask them, did you vote in the last election? If they didn't, it's easy to dismiss them because they've not put their 2 cents in.
Cannon has seen the studies. They say young people don't vote, they don't care about politics, and they don't know the issues. We decided to test these theories at Ball State University.
Do you really care about politics?
Not really.
Who are the congresspeople running in your home district?
Oh, I can't think of them.
Do you know who the vice presidential candidates are?
I don't even know the vice president candidates.
A lot of them don't know anything and aren't voting.
Apparently not. It's a classic complaint of political experts and the media. But Ball State political science professor John Craner says it's not fair to single out young people.
Students may be less able or less willing or less attentive, but I think they're probably fairly representative of the wider public.
Students have their own complaints too. They say politicians don't care about them, the issues don't affect them, and they're just worried about getting to their next class. Craner says we shouldn't judge students just on their voting habits.
Young people participate, but not necessarily in voting. And I'm continually amazed at the number of people who do volunteer time to outlets that we don't consider political.
He says declining voter turnout doesn't bother him.
I'm not so concerned about the numbers of people who do or do not vote. What I'm really interested in are the quality of those people who do vote.
All the students we spoke to said they were voting.
Yes, I'm like really big in politics.
Should we be worried about the quality of these voters? Not necessarily. Some students did give positive answers.
Do you know who's running for Congress in your home district?
Dr. Paul Perry and John Hostetler.
Some of them, you know, don't care, but I think most of them care and know about it.
Craner says he's optimistic.
It's part of growing up. It's part of maturation. They'll come around.
Definitely. Definitely think I'll, like, look at all the issues more closely as I get older.
There are still complaints on both sides.
If you don't vote, don't complain.
But until young people start going to the polls, their complaints may fall on deaf ears.
Well, there you see it. Lots of young people don't even know who the candidates are, although I have heard some that say, I don't know, so I'm not going to vote. So you have to respect that decision, that if they don't know who the candidates are and they don't know the issues, that they're just not going to vote in that area. Of course, they also say, you know, I also know I really don't have any room to complain if I don't like the person that does get elected. So, of course, a two-way street on that. John, you voted correct. You said you did.
Absolutely. And you saw some of those students. Some of those students came out looking a lot worse than they actually are. Students, for the most part, as Dr. Craner said in that story, are not bad people. It's not that they don't pay attention to things. It's just that they don't feel that their vote matters. Obviously, in an election like this, that's why we're seeing voter turnout so high, is because people are actually getting the idea that their vote is actually going to make a difference. Back in 1960, when it was one vote per 100,000 precincts across the country, 100,000 votes total, that swung the balance between the Republicans and Democrats, it's really obvious that one vote really does make a difference, especially in smaller precincts and smaller states where there aren't the mass of people voting.
Especially, you could just look at Delaware County with the surveyor's race, how close that was. It looks like maybe a few hundred votes could have made the difference there. Even looking at some of these states that we're still waiting for reports on, Wisconsin, virtually tied 6,000 votes. That's not even half of Ball State's population. And of course, we know that basically everyone at Ball State is old enough to vote. Whether or not they're registered, that's the question. Registered in Delaware County or registered in your home state, home county, it doesn't matter. It's just kind of whether or not you are and whether you're taking advantage of that opportunity and that privilege, the right given to you by the Constitution.
And of course, this once again brings up the idea of the popular vote versus the Electoral College vote. The fact that we vote in Indiana, which was almost given, as soon as the polls closed, they announced that Indiana, one of the first two states to be actually declared as going towards George W. Bush. The fact that you live in Indiana, you may feel that if you're a Democrat, then your vote may not matter as much because the rest of the people in Indiana are voting Democrat. Under a popular voting system, maybe that changes a little bit. But with the Electoral College, that's one of the reasons you're seeing some complaints, especially this year, where the popular vote could go one way and the Electoral College vote.
The home of Vice President Al Gore, and it appears maybe there's going to be some kind of a speech of sorts, but Bush did win that state. He did win Tennessee, so who knows what we have coming up from Tennessee. We'll stick around to find out.
Election 2000 coverage live on NewsCenter 43.
A live shot from Nashville, Tennessee, and it's safe to presume that Al Gore will be making either a concession or a victory speech from Tennessee, his home state. Here, maybe within the hour, next 2 hours, we're not really for sure at this point. We're still waiting on returns from Florida, Iowa, Wisconsin, and Oregon. Lots of possibilities there that could give Al Gore the win or the loss. Bush right now is up 2% in Florida. Should Bush win Florida, then he will win this election, assuming that all other states are correct in their numbers and whatnot, and that we have correct totals on those. Correct, John?
All of those races are too close to call. We are getting those results in as fast as we can. People are working hard over there in the election center. We've got lots of people over there. Dustin Grove is going to run down some of the races that we do have in. Dustin, what do you have for us?
Well, actually, the District 3 congressional seat has been won. Tim Romer won that one. We'll get to that in just a minute. So now we have all of the local numbers. But let's start with the presidential race. Like you were talking about, Florida is almost ready to call this one, but Bush at 49%, Gore's just trailing at 48% so far. Moving right along to, I believe, the electoral votes. Bush still has 246 to Gore's 242. Those key states still a deciding factor in who wins this race. For District 1 Commissioner, the winner has been declared Jack Stonebreaker by 53%. For District 2, we have James St. Meyer at 53%. The county council at large, we have Todd Donati, Alan Brammer, and Tracy Barton. Those are the three winners for the council at large. For surveyor, I believe we're moving on. I'm sorry. Yes, surveyor. We have a winner, Richard Thornburg, elected to the position of surveyor with all precincts in, 51%. Tiny Adams for District 34, he's the incumbent, reelected by 60% of the vote. District 35, we have Bill Munson, who won that one. He is the incumbent, he's reelected. That was by 57%. District 54, Thomas Saunders wins that one. He was also the incumbent. Republicans will keep that seat. That was by 65%. Moving on to State Senate. Beverly Gard, she is the incumbent. Once again, the Republican reelected to that one by 89%. Moving on to Indiana governor, as we've been reporting all night and was expected, Governor Frank O'Bannon reelected to another term by 56%, beating out McIntosh of Muncie. Moving on to attorney general, the winner here was Steve Carter by 54%. He edged out incumbent Karen Freeman Wilson by 44%. The superintendent of public education, Sue Ellen Reed, won that one. She was the incumbent. She's reelected by 59%. U.S. Senator, the winner there, Richard Lugar, incumbent. He was a Republican elected to a record fifth term in the Senate there, Senator Richard Lugar. Indiana District 1, checking those numbers, the winner was Peter Vislosky. He's won that one by 74%. District 2, Mike Pence. He's the winner here, the Republican, and he took David McIntosh's seat there. In District 3, as I said earlier, this just in, Tim Romer, the incumbent, has been reelected. He's a Democrat. He's reelected to District 3 by 52% of the vote. District 4, we have Mark Souder. He's the incumbent there, a Republican, winning there by 63% of the vote. In District 5, Steve Bouyer, the incumbent, also a Republican, 61% of the vote over Democrat Goodnight's 38%. In District 6, Republican Dan Burton, who is the incumbent, also a Republican, reelected by 71% with 99% of the precincts voting. Indiana District number 7, Brian Kearns, elected by 65%. And District 8, John Hostetler, the incumbent, a Republican, reelected by 53% of the vote. That's with 95% reporting, but it has been declared a winner there. District 9, Barron Hill, elected the winner there. He's the incumbent, a Democrat now, re-elected in District 9 by 55%. And District 10, this was expected, Democrat Julia Carson, the incumbent, re-elected to another term by 59%. She edged out her Republican Scott, who has been a contestant in that race for the last few elections there. Those are the latest numbers, and we will continue as we have been all night to update these numbers, and I promise we'll be here. We're not going anywhere.
All right. Back to you. All right, thanks, Justin. And we do still only have those four states left to report president, and we will check back with Election Center once they have numbers from there to report to us.
And we'll also check in with some of the main Senate seats, too. We've been talking a lot about some of these congressional districts. U.S. Senate Dick Lugar winning the Indiana seat once again. And there are also some other big Senate seats up for election. We'll get to those in just a couple of minutes. Right now, we've heard from most of our team of reporters who have been out and about East Central Indiana and in Indianapolis tonight. Ben Fisher is back from Democrat headquarters downtown Muncie, and he joins us now with some of the things that they had to say. Ben?
It was a big night for Democrats in Delaware County tonight. Both county commissioners won, so now there'll be three Democratic county commissioners. Tiny Adams won again at 34th District Representative, and we also have all three winners for county council, and we got a couple comments from some of those members tonight that won.
Not to know, but I think this is the first time that Delaware County has three. We did it in the city, I think, and this is the first time we have three county council at large candidates that are Democrats. And I'll tell you what, we told them one thing. For 6 years, we lowered taxes, we got county council, we got Delaware County back in the right direction.
Democrats take care of Democrats, and one thing that you did for Delaware County tonight, you set history because of the county council race, and I'm going to talk about it specifically because everybody else is going to talk about their race. You voted that you're pro-business, because I'm small business, and you proved that the Democrat Party, it's just about the good old boys. It's about good business for Delaware County. And that's important.
Lots of excitement from Democratic headquarters tonight, Ben. Looks like a lot of fun happening there.
Big night, a lot of beer being drank there at Democratic headquarters.
So. Of course, that's a part of election night, just relieving some of the tension, of course, that has been built up over these campaigns. We talked a little bit with some of the experts, expert analysis here from the political science department about Democratic Party unity. It's on the flyers that we showed that they've been sending out to people in Delaware County. A lot of tension within the Democratic Party here in the county. Does that seem to be resolved? Did everybody seem to get along tonight?
They seem very close tonight. All night long, people I talked to talked about how hard they had worked. They were proud of the fact that even though Bob Rock lost, he won in Delaware County. They were on the phone all day today, all the way up till 5:50. They were still on the phone trying to get people out to vote today.
Oh, that's when I had stopped in at some of the headquarters earlier today. It was running in and out. Can you go pick up this person to go vote? Can you go get these people? So lots of work by both of the parties in Delaware County to go out out and pick up people, the elderly and handicapped, so they can get out and vote as well. So that's what I had been seeing all day as well. So,
absolutely.
Yeah. All right, Ben. Well, thanks for all of your hard work this evening. We appreciate that.
Sure.
All right. Well, as we mentioned, we just want to talk about some of the U.S. Congress races that were going on across the United States. I guess we should start in New York. We have the Hillary Clinton and Rick Lazio race. It was neck and neck all the way up until this evening, but pretty much as soon as the polls closed in New York, it was declared that Hillary Clinton was the winner there. We had her acceptance speech. As we mentioned, right after the speech, she had a ton of people to thank. Of course, it was a huge campaign on her part. She came into this race under a lot of high criticism, people saying that she shouldn't represent New York. She's not from there. She doesn't know the issues. But it appears that Hillary Clinton has really taken a hold of the issues and gotten in there and just dug right in and found out what the needs are of the people in New York. So.
All right, yeah, absolutely. A lot of Senate seats. We'll get back to some of those. Right now, we've got some breaking news out of Florida. Paige Lewis is live in the Election Center with more. Paige, what do you have for us?
That's right. We're going to say it right now. In Florida, hasn't been decided yet, but we're going to take that graphic and show you what's happening. It is tied right now at 49-49. We have 94% of the votes voting, reporting, so we're waiting for 6 more percent. I mean, it is dead tied in Florida. We don't know what's going to happen. I mean, it's up to anyone right now. It's a big night for Bush and Gore. I mean, we're going to have to wait and see, though, and we will give you the latest as soon as we find out what's going on right here in the Election Center, and we'll have the latest coverage, and back to you guys.
Probably lots of double and triple counting down there in Florida, making sure they have things exactly right. Oh.
And, of course, that being a change from what we saw last time. Before, we saw Bush was actually ahead 50-48, so those things tightening up, as we talked about earlier. High voter turnout, especially in southern Florida with a large minority population. That would seem to favor Al Gore, minorities traditionally voting Democratic. And, of course, that has pushed that popular vote to a dead heat. It is tied in Florida, and it is fairly safe to say at this point that whichever candidate wins the state of Florida will win this presidential election.
Oh, absolutely, and we should point out before, if you hadn't heard yet, Gore, pretty much as soon as the polls closed in Florida, networks and various exiting polls, whatnot, had announced that Gore was the winner in Florida, but I guess just hours after that, that was retracted, and all the networks pulled back saying, nope, we're not really for sure yet. It's too close to call. So it's up for grabs. As you can still see, we're into almost 1:30. Polls closed in Florida, I believe, at 7 o'clock. So it has been a long night for those folks in Florida trying to figure out who they have elected as president.
And that retraction coming for good reason. As you can see, that race really is too close to call at this point, even too close to call with 94% of the precincts reporting. That is a number we'll continue to update. The people in the Election Center are working fast and furious to get that out to us and on the air as soon as possible so that we can find out who the next president of the United States will be. We're going to continue talking about some of these other races. We've got these Senate races. We talked about Hillary Clinton defeating Rick Lazio today in New York. Another race that has been in the public spotlight is with Mel Carnahan in the state of Missouri. Carnahan, of course, killed in that tragic accident. And Jared, just explain what happened there.
Well, we had Mel Carnahan. He was governor of Missouri. He was campaigning in the Senate seat. Just around the time of the presidential debate in Missouri, the St. Louis debate, the night before is when that plane crashed. The presidential debate almost called off, but they continued to go ahead and have that debate. Now we see that Carnahan, his wife, will accept his position should he win. And Carnahan is up against incumbent Ashcroft. Right now, that race is also very, very close. The last results showed 48-50% in favor of Ashcroft. So that, again, it's coming down to the last early morning hours here. Another race that we should mention that we spoke with one of our experts about earlier this evening, Joe Lieberman, of course, the vice presidential nominee with Al Gore. He is also running for a Senate seat in Connecticut. He did not take his name off that ballot. So right now, reports from the Associated Press have Lieberman winning 64-34%. So should Gore Lieberman not win the presidency, it appears that Lieberman still does have a seat secured in the Senate, a good thing for the Democrats as they're trying to hold on to as many seats as possible. Had Gore and Lieberman won the presidency, then Connecticut's governor, who is a Republican, would fill Lieberman's spot most likely, of course, with a Republican, so working against what all of the House, Senate, and Congress has been working toward to try to get that Democratic control.
And you just mentioned it right on the nose. The House and Senate, both currently Republican majorities. Senate a little closer than the House, but they felt that the House was really where they could pick up those votes that would transfer control back to the Democrats. But tonight, it seems that wasn't the case. We earlier said that it was 4 votes for the GOP, 4 seats were going towards the GOP, that is the Republican Party. But now that has actually gone back to only 1 seat, but still in the Republicans' favor as we look at those seats. And the Republicans will still have a majority in the House of Representatives, it appears. The Democrats have picked up a seat in the Senate tonight, but right now it looks like the Republicans will also retain a majority in the Senate. So Republican majorities in both the House of Representatives and the U.S. Senate looks like they will be intact for the next congressional session.
And, of course, big repercussions should Bush win the presidency. We will have a basically completely Republican-run government. So who knows? We're still waiting on these last 4 states to come in. At this point, we're going to go ahead and take a break. We'll be back in just about 2 minutes with more live coverage of Election 2000. Stay with us.
In East Central Indiana, there is only one place to turn for local news.
Left 2 million Serbian residents.
While Sate has gained national
news
attention.
NewsCenter 43.
America's
and Rule 7.
We're okay on time now, guys.
Clouds begin to
form. Muncie's only live TV newscast.
Reporting live. Only live.
On Saturday as we go to the highlight.
An official CNN Student Bureau. NewsCenter 43, Monday through Thursday at 5:30 and 9:30 on Burr's Channel 43.
Election 2000 coverage live on NewsCenter 43.
Welcome back, folks. We have about an hour and a half left in our coverage should we need that time. But if we find out from either Florida, Iowa, Wisconsin, or Oregon that Bush or Gore has won there, things will be looking much more favorable for us finding out who the president is very soon.
And of course, we have to remember that none of these totals will be final. Or as final in that way, we've seen that the chances of the popular vote and the Electoral College vote being different are actually within the realm of possibilities, in which case the Electoral College meeting in the middle of December would definitely have some interesting repercussions.
Most definitely. And actually, John, right now let's go ahead out to Paige Lewis. She joins us again from the Election Center with more results, some updates. Paige?
That's right. We want to talk about 3 states now. We mentioned Florida a little bit earlier. We also want to tell you about Wisconsin and Oregon, but we're going to start on the graphics for Florida. Right now, like we said just a little bit ago, we have Bush is winning by only 20,000 votes, and as you can see, 94% are reporting, tied dead even at 49%. We're going to move on to Wisconsin, another state we want to mention. We want to say that Bush is only up by 8,000 votes, tied there in Wisconsin, another major, major one there, and they have 82% reporting. And Oregon, we wanted to tell you that there is a gap of about 27,000 for Bush, and we only have 58% reporting. Bush is up by 49 to 46, but we want to tell you that they won't know on Oregon till the end of the week because almost the whole state is mail-in votes. So, of course, we're going to keep you updated and have those as soon as those numbers come in. Back to you, John and Jared.
All right, Paige, thanks for those updates. We'll continuing to come back to you throughout the evening. Looks like we have the Nader effect popping up in a few places, Wisconsin, Oregon.
Definitely, making those races a lot closer than perhaps they would have been. Also in Iowa, important to mention, the lead there in Iowa, only a mere 600 votes at this point is the total that was just told to me. That's just insanely close. That's very close, Gore leading only by 600 votes. It doesn't get much closer than that. The only little bit closer you could get that than that would be less than 600 votes, and that doesn't happen.
No, it doesn't happen very often, and we certainly haven't seen a race this close, especially in our lifetime. But going back to 1960, of course, that was safe to say, the closest presidential election ever with Nixon and Kennedy in that race, and it'd just be amazing to see how things come out in this race, because as of right now, the Electoral College is so close, it's anyone's game.
Actually, it's not quite safe to say that that was the closest race ever, because there was one earlier than that. I believe John Quincy Adams, in his race, actually had to go to the House of Representatives choose the president in that race a long time ago, long before any of us were around. So very forgivable, not to mention that. We've got George W. Bush, 246. There you see the totals. Al Gore, 242. You see that map, mostly yellow. George W. Bush winning a lot of the states with fewer electoral votes, a lot of the threes and fours as far as electoral votes. You see Idaho, Montana, Wyoming, North and South Dakota, etc. A lot of the Midwest and the South going towards George W. Bush. A lot of New England, the Northeast, and also out west going towards Al Gore. And if that trend continues, we may see either one as president. Again, the key state is Florida.
Waiting again for their returns, which we thought we had had earlier in the evening, but now it appears Florida is just so neck and neck that they're probably double, triple counting their votes just to make sure that they have things right. And of course, there will be more counting and stuff throughout probably the rest of the week just to make sure that things are actually correct all the way up until those actual electoral votes are cast in December. So maybe we should talk a little bit about what's going to happen for the loser of this election. Texas Governor George Bush, of course, he is still governor should he lose. His term is not up yet. So he's pretty safe with that.
Obviously, George W. Bush will have a job. He'll be the governor of Texas. Go back to that. And Al Gore, his term is ending as vice president. Whether or not he runs for political office again, that's yet to be known. More than likely, he won't disappear from the political front totally. Al Gore may take a position on the lecture circuit. It's unclear right now, especially with if Al Gore loses, what would be a Republican administration. Obviously, Al Gore may not get a prominent post within that administration, but he will definitely be on the political landscape for many years to come, it appears, regardless of who wins. And George W. Bush, if he wins or if he loses, he will still be governor of Texas, working on that job there. It's a big state to have to govern.
Definitely, and we've already mentioned that Lieberman, the Democratic vice presidential candidate, has been reelected to his senatorial seat in Connecticut, so his job is safe. At this point, we'll go ahead and check in with Dustin Grove. He's in Election Center. Dustin, what do you have for us?
Well, we're going to go ahead and show you all the numbers that we have so far, and we're going to take another look, as we have been, of the presidential numbers. Bush and Gore still neck and neck, as this is historical. 49% Bush and Gore's 48%. Historical, not hysterical, but historical. Buchanan and Nader having a little effect at 3%. Though, moving on to these electoral votes, Gore needs Florida and one more state to win this election. Bush needs Florida, or he needs Oregon, Iowa, and Wisconsin to win the race. So we're waiting on those factors, and once we get those, we'll have our next president. 49%, here you see the votes from Florida, 94% of the precincts reported from Florida, and they are at a dead heat, 49%, both of them. Another state that is very close, Wisconsin, 82%, they're a little slower getting their votes out, but they're both tied at 48%. Moving right along, Oregon votes are, they're a little slower as well, but Bush is in the lead there, 49% to Gore's 46%. Let's check those local election results now. We have winners in every election race. Jack Stonebrenner is the winner by 53% for County Commissioner in District 1. In District 2, James St. Meyer is the winner there for Commissioner in District 2. For the council at large, we have Barton at 18,774 votes, Brammer 19,188 votes, and Donati at 19,658 votes. Moving right along, we have Flowers at 18,592, Robertson, 16,889, and Russell, who is the incumbent, at 17,862. And McShirley, 3,033, and Trapp at 3,284. For Surveyor, Richard Thornburg has won that one, 51%, the Republican over Dickerson's 49%. District 34, Tiny Adams, the incumbent, a Democrat, wins that one by 60% to Kay Whitehead's 40% in that race. District 35 Representative Mr. Munson, Bill Munson, wins that one. He is the Republican incumbent, 57% over Shepard's 43%. District 54, Thomas Saunders, the Republican incumbent, 65% over Totoro's 35%. For the Senate race, Beverly Gard wins it again, a Republican incumbent, by 89%. In the governor's race, again, Governor Frank O'Bannon wins this one against Republican David McIntosh. O'Bannon won that by 56% to a second term. Attorney General Steve Carter won that one, a Republican, by 54%, edging out Karen Freeman Wilson, who is the incumbent, by 44%. The Superintendent of Education, winner there, Sue Ellen Reed, the Republican incumbent. She won that one by 59%. The U.S. Senator, Richard Lugar, incumbent, a Republican. He is elected to a fifth term as senator, a record here in Indiana, by 67%, edging out Johnson and Hager. Indiana District 1, Veselovsky, the incumbent Democrat there, 74%. Peter Veselovsky winning that one for U.S. Congress in District 1. District 2, Mike Pence of Columbus. He took David McIntosh's seat for District 2 right here in Muncie. That's 51% he won that one by. District 3, Tim Romer, the Democrat incumbent, won that one by 52%. Moving right along to District 4, Mark Sauter was the winner there by 63%. Moving to District 5, Steve Bouyer, the Republican incumbent, wins that one by 61%. That's District 5. District 6, the winner there was Dan Burton, also a Republican incumbent. That was by 71%. District 7, Brian Kearns won that one, 65% over Graff and Thayer. And in District 8, John Hostetler won that one, the Republican incumbent, by 53% over Perry and Tindall. District 9, Barron Hill won that one. He's the Democrat incumbent. That was by 55%. And finally, in District 10, this was an expected outcome. Democrat incumbent Julia Carson edged out Scott 59% to 40%. Those are the latest results. We'll continue to watch this presidential race as we receive more information. Florida, and here we are, Florida is waiting on 1 million votes to be tallied, many of which are expected to favor Bush. That's from WNDU-TV in South Bend. So, like I said, we'll continue to watch it. We'll be on till 3. Live in the Election Center, I'm Dustin Grove. John and Jared?
1 million votes. That is a lot left to count, so it could take a little bit longer than we expected, John.
But still, that's 95% of the votes already counted. So probably not too much longer until we find out who the next president of the United States is. Be sure to stay tuned. More of NewsCenter 43's live team election coverage coming up.
Election 2000 coverage live on NewsCenter 43.
And we're back now with our live coverage. Here you see some numbers from the Indiana District 10 where Julia Carson did win earlier this evening. And now you see that presidential map. We're still waiting. There you see him in the white. It's Florida, Wisconsin, Iowa, and Oregon that we're all waiting for. Dustin Grove just reported to us that it appears Florida is still waiting on about a million ballots to be counted, but that they do have 95% of their precincts already reporting. So still waiting on those four states so we can declare a president.
Obviously, this is something which we've been waiting on all evening long. Florida, in case you're just tuning in, was originally cast to Al Gore. The network's Associated Press said Al Gore has won Florida. Eventually, they had to retract that statement and say George Bush has caught up to Al Gore. This is now too close to call. George Bush has gone into the lead a couple of times, and now the race is simply too close to call with yet 1 million ballots left to be counted, only 5% of those precincts left to report in Florida.
This is amazing, almost unheard of, especially at this point, we thought, as John said, we thought Gore had overtaken Florida, and now it's just a matter of waiting. We're in this huge holding pattern, waiting for someone to make an announcement in Florida or one of those other states, Wisconsin, Oregon, or Iowa. And it appears that in some of those states, we're very close to making an announcement. I believe Oregon, we're leaning toward Bush. Is that correct, John?
And then, that is correct.
And then Wisconsin, or Iowa, rather, for Gore.
Iowa and Wisconsin have both been leaning towards Gore, but by very, very, very narrow margins. Gore actually only up by 600 votes at last count in the state of Iowa. Let's talk a little bit about some of the uncontested county races that we had. We did have two races for circuit court judge here in Delaware County. Those races were uncontested. Stephen Caldemeyer in Circuit Court District 1, reelected as circuit court judge, and in District 2, Richard Daley, both Democrats, reelected to their judicial positions for another term. Caldemeyer, a circuit court judge since 1983, also helped with the creation of the Youth Opportunity Center, and also Richard Daley. He's been a judge for 24 years, started a supervised bail program here in Delaware County. Again, we're still waiting on the presidential numbers. It is that close. We have not seen something like this since 1960. 246 electoral votes for George W. Bush, 242 for Vice President Al Gore. Again, 270 is the magic number. It's been just lasered into our brains. 270 votes. We've worked out the math as many different ways as we can figure. Florida is the key state. If George W. Bush wins Florida, he wins the election. If Al Gore wins Florida, he then needs to win one other state in order to win the election. Thus, George Bush has a few more options than Al Gore. So, Jared, do you really think that right now the election seems to be leaning in Bush's favor?
It appears it does. At the beginning of the evening, it seemed that Gore really was going to come back from that very narrow of a margin of a lead that Bush had over him, but at this point it seems like it's anybody's game. Of course, it doesn't appear that Gore is going to have any problem winning that one other state. It's just a matter of whether or not he can win Florida to secure all those electoral votes and needing 270. So it's just a matter of looking at all that. And then looking here at the state level, we have announced basically all of our winners. We know all the winners in those areas. If you haven't caught those yet, you can check those numbers out on our website. You can go to www.bsu.edu/news. There's a link on there to our homepage here at News Center 43. You can check out all those scores. We've been updating them throughout the night. Even there are still some precincts that are left to report, but the winners have been declared. So we'll continue to keep those updated and exact for you.
And also, you see at the bottom of your screen, you've been seeing it all evening long, our Election 2000 ticker. As soon as we get the latest updated results, we are putting them on that ticker and on the website so that you can see them in as many ways as possible, trying to get you up to the second results for the races that matter here for voters in Delaware County.
All right, John, at this point, we're going to head back out to Election Center. Paige Lewis joins us now with some new news on Florida.
That's right. I'm back again, and we have some information from Florida from WFTV in Orlando. We wanted to show you right now that they're reporting that Bush has 50% of the votes, while Gore is trailing behind in 2% with 48% of the votes. They have 95% reporting right now. Again, that's WFTV in Orlando. And of course, we're keeping you updated as the night goes along, and we'll have continuing coverage here from the Election Center. Back to you, John, Jared.
All right, thanks, Paige. And of course, we were saying earlier in the evening, should Bush lose that state, a huge upset overall because his brother Jeb Bush is governor there. So it was kind of assumed that brother Governor Bush would pull along presidential candidate George W. Bush in that state. But there's been just a lot of issues that Gore has really tackled as far as Social Security, Medicare, especially with a lot of the elderly and retired persons living there. So lots of issues, lots of things that could really keep this Florida race going.
Again, and you mentioned a lot of the traditionally Democratic issues. Some of the people, a lot of the elderly vote in Florida, voting on issues like Social Security, Medicare, prescription drug coverage, worried about whether or not those things are going to be there for them when they need them. A lot of people have trouble paying for prescription drugs, especially as they get older. That's not necessarily completely due in part to the drug companies, but just due to the fact that there are so many new drugs out there that are available to help enrich seniors' lives and to provide treatment for things that were once untreatable. So once again, WFTV in Orlando reporting with 95% of precincts in, George W. Bush holding a 2% lead over Al Gore. Again, the state of Florida previously thought to have gone towards Gore would have been a huge victory for him early on in the evening, but now it looks like George W. Bush may still pull it out.
But the way things are going, who knows, it still could turn out that Gore could still come back and overcome Bush in this state. It's this huge holding pattern that we're in right now. And while we're in that holding pattern, John, let's come ahead back to the state and talk about a few other issues that were on the ballot. Some people may have just looked at them. I know I did, and I had to look at it a little while and think, what is this? I'm talking about the some of the questions about retaining judges, Indiana district court judges, that kind of thing. A lot of people really didn't know about those, but it appears that all of those judges have been reelected.
Again, that's a matter of retention for the Indiana Court of Appeals judges. Instead of facing a direct election, the ballot basically says, should we keep this person in office? And there were a couple of them in this district and a couple of other ones in districts across the state, a number of different judges for the Indiana Court of Appeals facing retention votes. Also, another ballot question that did appear on the ballots, it did seem kind of confusing. It dealt with amending the Constitution, the Indiana Constitution, dealing with the way that civil appeals are handled. And basically what the ballot issue said was, should the courts handle civil complaints and civil appeals the same ways that they handle criminal appeals? And so that ballot issue did pass. We have received results on that. That ballot question did pass, although obviously not the most important thing on voters' minds as they went to the polls.
No, exactly. You would think that maybe some people would just read through it real quick and go ahead and vote yes or no, not really knowing really what it means, but just feeling like they have to vote for it. So I know I had to read it a couple times really to make sure that I understood the whole question.
The response that I got from a number of people whom I talked to about this was if the government feels it's important enough to put it to a referendum to ask the people of Indiana to approve this, then it must be good enough to approve it, even if they didn't understand the issue, which isn't necessarily a good thing. Obviously, you want to understand any issue that shows up on a ballot. But for those voters who really didn't have any way to research this matter, just that idea of if it's good enough for the government, it's good enough for us is the idea.
Right, and we should mention along the lines of those judges that were reappointed, they really don't have opponents. It's just, and they're not really candidates. They don't run a campaign per se. It's just also a matter of the same kind of referendum. Should we keep them?
Again, those are the last things on the ballot, some very, very minor issues. A lot of other state issues that were very much decided today. We did see a very high voter turnout throughout the state of Indiana. And one thing we also saw was a lot of voters splitting their tickets. We saw a Democratic governor, a Republican attorney general. We saw Republican and Democratic congressmen being voted in. A lot of incumbents reelected throughout the state. So a lot of voters in Indiana, even though it's traditionally a Republican state, most of them not afraid to split their tickets one way or another.
Oh, absolutely not. It seems people just vote the way they want to almost. A lot of times it's not so much the party, because so many times now you get the Republicans that are more liberal in their way of thinking, or the Democrats that are more conservative. So it's seems like a lot of people are moving away from the party system in some areas. Indiana may be one of those places, and it's just a matter of image, a matter of opinion, how you take your opinion on commercials, advertising, that kind of thing.
And that speaks a lot for how politics is done in Indiana. In Indiana, the Democrats are conservative enough that in the New England states where people are very liberal, the Democrats in Indiana might be considered very conservative for Democrats in New England. So there's a wide spectrum of going from conservative on the right and Republicans to liberals on the left. The Democrats, generally Indiana tends to stay more conservative on the right side, and even the Democrats in Indiana agree more with Republicans in some of the more liberal states.
All right, well, that's our take on the issues here for right now. A little bit of info for you on some judges and general questions on the ballot. We're going to take a quick break. We're still waiting on those states for the presidential election. We'll be back in just a few minutes to see if we have any more results. Stay with us.
Election 2000 coverage live on NewsCenter 43.
And we are back now live at the top of the hour. It is now 2 o'clock on the East Coast, 11 o'clock, still on November 7th on the West Coast. And we're still waiting for returns from all across the nation. So that time difference is making no difference right now.
Of course, all the polls are already closed. It's not a matter of which polls close first. It's just a matter of getting all those votes counted and how close those vote totals actually are. The way it works, those votes start coming in. If mathematically it looks like one candidate has a lead that the other candidate can't overcome, then the networks, as along with the Associated Press and a number of other media outlets, then declare that candidate the winner of that state. And as it goes, we've already had one mistake with that tonight.
Absolutely. If you may recall, in Florida, Al Gore, essentially right after the polls closed in Florida, he was announced as the winner in Florida, that Florida had elected him as president. But just merely hours later, that was retracted by the Associated Press and the networks, and that state is once again up for grabs. But here you see it right now, 50% for Bush, 48% for Gore. That source is from WFTV in Orlando, still reporting only 95% of the precincts that have brought in their totals. There you see it, four states still up for grabs: Florida, Wisconsin, Iowa, and Oregon. So we are still waiting for those states to see who will be put over the top over that 270 electoral votes to determine the next president of the United States. Hopefully we will know in this next hour, because we are only on for another hour with you as of right now. So it would be great if we could get that news to you within the hour. Of course, it's not up to us. It's up to those counting the ballots. About a half hour ago, Paige Lewis in Election Center told us that there are still about 1 million ballots left to count in Florida, but probably won't take too long. We're assuming that they have some computers and whatnot that count those ballots fairly quickly.
And those ballots are being counted. We have to reassert that none of these totals are final. In Oregon, for example, one of the states that we're still waiting on, many of the, almost half of the ballots are mail-in ballots, and therefore we may not find out the official totals from Oregon until possibly the end of this week. And then after that, once we find out what the actual vote totals are, then the Electoral College has to meet in the middle of December. I believe it's the third week of December that they meet and actually cast the electoral votes that they have been pledged to do in favor of one candidate or another.
At this point, we'll just go ahead and get away from the presidential election a little bit. Head back to one of the Senate seats that we've been bringing to you this evening. We mentioned Hillary Clinton and Rick Lazio. We also mentioned Lieberman winning in Connecticut, winning his senator seat. So should the Gore-Lieberman camp not win the presidency, Lieberman will still have a job in the Senate. But the other one we've been bringing to you, the late Mel Carnahan, former governor of Missouri until his death just a few weeks ago. He was running for a Senate seat there against incumbent Ashcroft, and it is now being brought to us that Mel Carnahan has won in Missouri, and his wife will be appointed to his seat there. The governor, it's up to him to decide who will replace Carnahan, and he selected Carnahan's wife, and she did accept that nod. So also a lot of controversy with that, because the Constitution says that the person must be an inhabitant of that state, a legal resident, but as we know, Carnahan is not technically an inhabitant. He is deceased. So there's been a lot of discussion there, a lot of controversy that the Republican Party has tried to bring up. So there may be, this story may not be over yet. We may see more of this here in the next coming weeks.
And we've got Mel Carnahan. Actually, we have Kate Snow, who is live in St. Louis with some information.
With her announcement, a lot of excitement here. Mrs. Carnahan spoke to this crowd just a short time ago. She talked about carrying on the fire, carrying on her husband's dreams. She, of course, has not been very public in this whole campaign. In fact, voters here in Missouri only saw Mrs. Carnahan a very few times throughout this race over the last 3 weeks since the death of her husband. They saw her in one ad that aired on local television here. They saw her in her announcement last week when she decided that, yes, she would take the position if the votes were to go to her husband. But other than that, they haven't seen much of Mrs. Carnahan. She is right now at home with two of her daughters in Rolla, Missouri. That's about an hour and a half south of where we are in St. Louis. This race has been close all night long. Senator John Ashcroft just a short time ago telling his supporters that they could go home now, that he would have more news for them in the morning. We don't expect to hear from him again anytime soon. Again, very good news for the Democrats here in Missouri, especially in light of the fact that George W. Bush seems to have won this battleground state. Bernie?
All right, and there you saw Kate Snow reporting with CNN. And as she mentioned, a big victory for the Democrats. They're a huge upset over the Republicans, incumbent Ashcroft being defeated by the deceased Mel Carnahan. I have to wonder if there's some sympathy votes still going ahead out and making your votes for this man, even though he's not around anymore to fill the shoes of the Senate seat.
Well, it may seem surprising on the surface, but when you really look at it, when you see Mel's wife actually stepping in to volunteer to take that seat, you see that generally in politics, you see President Clinton and the First Lady, Hillary Clinton, matching up very well on the issues. Most voters see that where a politician stands on the issue, chances are his or her spouse stands the same way on those issues. And so this may have just been a testament to the fact that Mel Carnahan would have won this seat anyway, even if he hadn't passed away, and that Jean Carnahan is just a continuation of her late husband in the issues that he stood for, and that she will carry out the same issues and the same policies that Carnahan would have had he been in office.
Reports today from St. Louis said that there were lines up to 3 hours long waiting to get in and vote. Possibly an effect of this whole Carnahan situation. Maybe not. Maybe there's just a lot of voters that were really waiting to get out and vote today. Not really for sure on that either.
Definitely. We've got Paige Lewis, who's in the Election Center now. A little more presidential returns now.
That's
and,
right.
And she's got Iowa for us.
That's right. We have some breaking news. We haven't had a state called in 2 hours now, so we want to give you the latest on Iowa with 7 electoral votes. Al Gore took that one. And right now, Gore is in the lead with 249 electoral votes over Bush with 246. Like we said, 270 needed to win. And if Gore gets Florida, he's the winner. So we will keep you updated. And back to you, John and Jared, in the studio.
Well, amazing news there, Paige. Thank you so much. It's been the same story all night, except now we're moving into Gore, where if Gore takes Florida, he is the president. Where for the past 2 hours or so, we've been saying, should Bush take Florida, he is the winner. Gore has now surpassed Bush with electoral votes. So it is still anybody's game.
And as we've said for probably the last hour or so, it's coming down to what we've said, pretty much all night. We've said that Florida would be a very important state. After it was retracted that Gore had won Florida, we said that Florida was an even more important state. And now that these results are coming in, Florida is the only state in effect. Florida is the only way that either candidate can win right now. Bush could have won by taking Iowa, Wisconsin, and Oregon, but obviously with Gore taking Iowa right there, then Florida is the only one left that will make a difference in this 2000 presidential election. Oregon, Wisconsin, all those states are important mainly to see exactly what the Nader effect was, whether
exactly.
or not Nader will get his 5% of the vote that he needed in order to secure federal funds for the next election cycle. But Oregon, Wisconsin, not really going to make much of a difference as far as the presidential election is concerned. It's Florida that we're watching now, Florida that we've had our eyes on for the last couple of hours. And you may hear it later tonight after the winner is announced. You may hear one of these candidates say after he's elected president, I'm going to Disney World.
Most definitely. That would be interesting to hear that. Of course, that term becoming popular well over the years. So we'll see how things turn out there. Florida, once again, we're waiting for you, Florida. Let's see how much longer it's going to take. We only have about 50 minutes left with you here on air. Hopefully we have some kind of results to give to you before the end of this final hour, going into 3 o'clock in the morning here on the East Coast. It's going on midnight now on the West Coast. So still November 7th out there, still their election day, but again, really the only state out on the West Coast still waiting to report is Oregon. So as you mentioned earlier, it's not a matter of when the polls close, it's just how many votes they have and trying to make sure that they have the exact counts in those places.
And actually, we do have some news in from Florida. Paige Lewis is live in the Election Center with more. Paige, what do you have for us?
That's right. We want to tell you about Florida. We want to show you that one. Bush, we want to say as of 2:07 a.m. on CNN.com, Bush is ahead with 29,387 votes. So he is up merely by 0.5%. We have 96% reporting. And of course, we're going to keep you updated. I mean, this is a close race, and we're just waiting for the final results. Like we said, Gore with 249 of the electoral votes, Republican George W. Bush with 246 of the results. He is actually right now in Florida, it is 49.1% for George W. Bush and 48.6% for Al Gore, as we're seeing right now on CBS News in Florida right there. So, of course, we're going to keep you updated. We'll be back probably in just a few minutes with those results as they come in. Back to you.
All right. Thanks for those continuous break-ins, Paige. We appreciate that. Who knows what really the ballots that we're waiting on, what area of the state, because some areas of the state tend to vote more Democrat, more Republican. So it's interesting to see what areas we're actually waiting on at this point.
And of course, both George W. Bush and Al Gore are waiting for this news. A report from WNDU earlier out of South Bend saying that the precincts that they're waiting for in Florida tend to vote mostly Republican. In the past, of course, with this election, everything is, you can throw history out the window, because this is something that we're not used to seeing. Here we're seeing a live look of Nashville, Tennessee, where Al Gore and his supporters are gathering. They are waiting for the announcement of Florida as well. Tennessee already having been lost to George W. Bush. Al Gore called that a crushing blow earlier. The state where he was originally from, where he was a senator before he became vice president under President Bill Clinton, and definitely a crushing blow for Vice President Al Gore, and a big victory for George W. Bush, not just a moral victory, but because Tennessee actually has, I believe, 12 electoral votes that really counted toward that total.
And there you see it, the people putting up their umbrellas, almost raining down, kind of a symbolic cry over the Gore supporters there. So we'll check back in with that live shot back in Nashville, Tennessee, throughout the evening. And of course, we're still waiting in that huge holding pattern, waiting to see the outcome in Florida, who will ultimately decide who will be the next president of the United States.
And of course, a little later on, we'll check in Austin, Texas, where the Bush supporters are actually awaiting for the results as well. My understanding is that it's raining there also. So
actually, they've had quite a bit of bad weather, it seems, recently. Lots of floods and that kind of stuff. So I wonder if that affected voter turnout down there.
Well, there were some places where heavy storms, snowstorms, did affect voter turnout. New Mexico saw some very fierce storms in that area of the Southwest, in the Rockies. They did see some very heavy rain, very heavy snow that did keep some voters from going to the polls. And that, whether or not that will actually have an effect on the race remains to be seen. New Mexico, Texas were pretty much given to Bush right away. So whether or not those were key votes that were kept from going to the polls probably isn't a probability, but still, bad weather can have an effect. It's causing some people to go indoors instead of remaining outside for the election night results. Everybody says they are excited. George W. Bush in Austin, Texas has said, "I am excited." They're biting their nails. They are crossing their fingers. They're doing anything that they can to make themselves the next president of the United States.
And we are biting our nails here, waiting for returns. We hopefully will have some more returns right after this break. Stay with us.
Election 2000 coverage live on NewsCenter 43.
All right, and we're back now going into the final 45 minutes of our coverage here with you. We're on until 3 o'clock on Channel 43. And we're trying to keep you up to date on our website. You can check it out at www.bsu.edu/news. Check out the link there to our website. You can get all the returns numbers on all the local races and state, president, whatnot. Right now you're taking a live look from Nashville, Tennessee. We were there just before we cut to the break, and waiting on some kind of speech by Al Gore, whether it be a concession speech or a victory speech. At this point, we're waiting on Florida to determine what exactly that will be.
And we're not quite sure exactly when that will be or what it will be. We heard earlier in the evening that George W. Bush was going to give his speech, regardless of what it was, at 11:20. Obviously, that didn't happen.
We're way past that.
Conditions have not lent themselves to giving a speech at 11:20, and we are still waiting to see who's going to give what speech, because we still don't know that. It's still a delay, and we are going to bring you those results as they come in.
Just to let you know what we have coming up, we'll continue to keep you up to date on the presidential race. As soon as we have numbers on those, we'll let you know, and we'll go to the election center just to show you a few things in there and keep you up to date with Paige Lewis and Dustin Grove, rather. And it's been a long night, John. We've had lots of things going on, lots of surprises, I guess you could say.
And it has been a long night. We've had relatively few surprises, actually. And it's been a long night for the people in the election center, too. Dustin Grove is there right now. Dustin, what's going on in there?
Well, it's pretty busy, as you can tell. And actually, you've seen us throughout the evening, the people on your screen. You know what we do. But what you don't necessarily know is what these people do right here. This is the election center. This is really the nerve center of our election coverage tonight. We're going to talk to some of the people and talk about what they're doing. Margie, what's your name and what was your job tonight?
I'm Margie Zihar, and I was working on the national results for the congressional races and the presidency.
Okay, we have some breaking news. Let's go back to the anchor desk.
Okay, Dustin, we're sorry we have to interrupt you at this point. We need to go to Austin, Texas, where it appears that George W. Bush has won the election. We are expecting some kind of speech here very, very shortly. But we still, we have not received any numbers on Florida, but according to the Bush camp, they have gotten those numbers and that they have won in Florida. So it appears that your next president of the United States will be George W. Bush, but we are awaiting that announcement from the man himself.
Still waiting for that official confirmation. You see the people in the crowd there waving the Bush-Cheney signs, holding up those three fingers signifying the W for George W. Bush. And they are getting ready for something big. It has been a big night, and this is a big place. Texas, everything's bigger in Texas.
Oh, yeah.
And that's exactly what's preparing to happen if indeed George W. Bush has become the 44th president of the United States.
And as we've mentioned, those folks down there also battling the weather. We have some rainy conditions and whatnot, but it doesn't matter. They're out there to support George W. Bush and to hear what he has to say. Apparently, they have also heard what we just reported to you, that he has won, but we're still awaiting to hear that. We're still awaiting to see if Bush has, in fact, won in Florida.
We have not exact. There it is. You see President Bush Cheney. There is your Republican ticket declaring it right now, the next president and vice president of the United States of America. Although the exact numbers have not come in from Florida, the Bush campaign has claimed Florida. Victory is ours, is what the Bush campaign is saying. They say they have taken Florida. The numbers supported that fact that they had won Florida. Bush was ahead in Florida only by a slight margin, but those votes were almost done being tallied. And Florida, as we had said many times before, was the crucial state, the last one that would make a deciding factor in this election.
Absolutely, and as numbers become available to us, we will let you know those. We may cut away to go to our election center, but it appears there you see the map that Bush has taken Florida, moving him above that 270 mark to 271. That's actually all he needed was 270 to win, but he picked up a few extra points there along the way.
And 270, the magic number needed to win. 538 electors in the Electoral College. A majority of those is needed to win. That makes that magic number 270. And George W. Bush, governor of Texas, believes he has now reached 271 electoral votes. And we are waiting for confirmation from people in Florida, although we are declaring George W. Bush, the next president of the United States. You hear the fans, the Bush supporters who have worked long and hard and stayed up awfully late even there in Texas. It is going on 1:30 in the morning there in Texas, and they are up and they still look very excited.
Oh, absolutely. They are long awaiting. They have been long awaiting, as we have been, returns from Florida to see who the winner is. And as we have already said, we are declaring Bush the winner as well.
And this has been a hard-fought race. Let's recap exactly how this went tonight. We saw originally Florida, the first swing state, go towards Al Gore. Later on in the evening, about 9 o'clock, we saw that recounted. We saw that they said it's too close to call. Bush may have won Florida, which indeed now appears to have been the case. We looked at some of those other swing states. We saw them one by one fall to Al Gore, the Vice President of the United States. We saw Pennsylvania, then Michigan, then Minnesota. We saw New York go to the Gore camp. We then saw California go to the Gore camp. It looked as though Al Gore was going to win this race. But piece by piece, bit by bit, George W. Bush seemed to put together that coalition, that grand coalition of those smaller states as far as Electoral College numbers is concerned. George W. Bush started to put together those smaller states, put together those numbers, and including Tennessee, Al Gore's home state, including those 12 electoral votes, big electoral votes also in Missouri and some other states, and of course the biggest 25 electoral votes, probably the defining moment of George W. Bush's political career coming with this announcement that Florida has voted, pledged its support for George W. Bush, and thus he has gone over the 270 electoral vote mark, and George W. Bush will be the next president of the United States.
Yes, John, I'm checking out a few places here on the web right now. I just checked out abcnews.com, and they also are saying Bush takes it. So it appears that we definitely have a defeat here, and the son of a former president has taken the White House, and guess we will be seeing an inauguration here around, I believe it's January 20th, and we have once again seen Republicans take control of the White House. It appears they will also maintain control of the House and the Senate.
And of course, this being the first time since John Quincy Adams that we've seen a son become president after the father had been president, of course, with William Henry Harrison, then Benjamin Harrison from Indiana. We have seen people related to each other in the past become president. But it's so close together. George W. Bush, his term from 1988 through 1992. In the 1992 election, Bill Clinton and the Democrats taking control away. But now it is back to Republican territory. Of course, very important also to mention, the United States House of Representatives and the United States Senate both retain Republican majority control. Very helpful for George W. Bush in putting some of those GOP policies through the Congress and into law for the next 4 years.
Big, big night for the Republican Party. At this point, we're going to check in at Election Center with Dustin Grove. I think Justin has some exact numbers for us, some percentages.
We sure do. 49.2%. That was Bush's exact percentage. That's how he won in Florida. Gore had 48.4%. 49.2 to 48.4%. Checking the exact number, Bush won in Florida by 47,863 votes. That was, again, in Florida, ending one of the most competitive presidential races in a very, very, very long time. It was interesting. We waited. Let's take a look at that Electoral College map. And as you can see, as we've talked about, 271 votes. That's just one over the 270 needed to win a presidential election that goes to President-elect George W. Bush over Gore's 249. We've waited 2 hours with not much new information, and then immediately we got Iowa's information, and then here with Florida. And it really goes back to the polls that we've seen throughout really much of the election season. President Bush has been, while the race has been close, most national polls and even local polls have showed George W. Bush ahead of Al Gore, just by not very much. And so basically tonight, election night, what you've seen is exactly what people have predicted all throughout election season. This is one of the most hotly contested presidential elections in decades. I'm not that old, but knowing my history, I don't know of a presidential election that was this close, and it's been very interesting to be a part of this and been really a U.S. citizen. It's wonderful to take part in this, and pretty good. It's interesting, and it's historical, after all.
Absolutely.
John and Jared?
All right. Thanks a lot, Dustin. We may be checking back in with you. Thanks for all your hard work in there this evening. Here you're seeing a live look at Nashville, Tennessee. Not as much cheering, not as much hope anymore for those folks, those Gore supporters in Nashville, Tennessee. I see lots of somber faces, lots of disappointment. You have to wonder, John, at this point, what is going through Gore's mind?
Well, I can tell you one thing that's going through Gore's mind. I was that close. And especially with the way Florida had been called for Al Gore, his campaign had to be thrilled about that, defeating Bush in what was supposed to be a state that he would take, especially with his brother Jeb Bush being the governor of Florida. This has to be a crushing defeat for Al Gore. Obviously, any defeat when you've put such hard work, months, years even of hard work into a campaign like this, it has to be difficult for Vice President Gore. But it's something that I think he can feel good that he did put together a very close race, the closest race since 1960, right, since Kennedy-Nixon. Of course, we have to keep in mind that this is not technically over.
No.
A lot of these ballots still have not been counted in some of these states. A lot of these mail-in votes, a lot of these absentee ballots, a lot of these things which technically, although it looks right now on the surface that George W. Bush has won, and it may in the end turn out that way. Remember also the newspaper headline that read, Dewey defeats Truman.
Oh, I can't forget that at all. And you also have to take into consideration what Gore is going to do after this, or what he's going to say tonight, who he's going to be thanking, rather. Must be a lot going through his mind. And of course, the Republicans and Bush are absolutely sitting on a high right now.
Well, we know that President Clinton is not there in Nashville with him because he was in New York with his wife Hillary Clinton after she won her Senate seat in the state of New York. So President Clinton will not be there to give remarks for Vice President Gore. So chances are Vice President Gore will just be giving his own remarks, his concession speech, as it may, to Vice President, or to now President-elect George W. Bush, Vice President-elect Dick Cheney. There you see them right there on your screen. And of course, the numbers for the rest of the races scrolling on your election 2000 ticker at the bottom of your screen. We'll have all of the election results on the website, www.bsu.edu/news. We'll be going out to these speeches as they happen, and be sure to check out those results on the website as you are able to. All of the results will be there in case you miss any of these results tonight.
John, it's interesting to look back really right after the primaries to see how things started to work out. We had Bush way ahead in the polls. It really appeared that there was no chance that Gore was going to come back in this. Then we get into the summer months with the national conventions, the Republican being first. Bush takes an even bigger lead in the polls. Then we have the Democratic convention, and Gore just comes way ahead, blows Bush out of the waters, ahead by 8-10 points, even some polls projected, may have been that the infamous kiss that we saw on the final night of the convention. But then once things really started getting heated, we came into the last final weeks. We had all these appearances on Letterman and Leno and Oprah Winfrey that really, for a lot of people, that's their only way of finding out news on the politicians and the candidates. So it's interesting to see now how close it ended up being, and actually how close this will go down in the record books, as especially for Florida, who Gore thought he had, but now it appears he actually did not.
And we've been saying it for the past few weeks. All of the tracking polls that have come out have said that this race is just too close. There have been swings of 3 or 4% each day. Those things have gone back and forth. And remember, all of these polls have a margin of error of 3 or 4%. And all of the polls that we saw, most of them were within the margin of error. And so the polls don't necessarily indicate exactly what the public is thinking within that margin of error. Obviously, a little bit of faith, thinking that the system may actually work as it was planned, the popular vote and the Electoral College vote going the same way.
Back now in Austin, Texas, we have some singing America the Beautiful. It appears that we may have a speech coming up soon. Let's go ahead and take a listen.
patriotry that sees beyond the years, whose alabaster cities gleam undimmed by human tears. America, America, God shed his grace on you and crown thy good with brotherhood from sea to shining sea to shining sea. Thank you very much, everybody.
And we are expecting George W. Bush to make a speech very, very soon, much later than his anticipated speech at 11:20 earlier this evening. We're now 3 hours past that. We're almost going on 3 o'clock. It's 2:30 at this point, so this has been a long night for the Republicans.
It is good to know that we will get this in, though. Before we get off the air, we will be sure to get George W. Bush's acceptance speech for you. And it looks like they're getting ready to bring George W. Bush to the podium right now. You see a huge crowd in Austin, Texas. Obviously, thousands of people there to support him, his people of Texas. And it's going to be a couple minutes yet. Now we've heard before George W. Bush actually makes his speech. So we'll just have to wait and discuss this race a little bit more. And Jared, again, such a mixture of emotions, even though you and I haven't run for political office. We've heard some of the things that our reporters have been saying about the moods in some of the local offices. We can kind of empathize with these candidates, how they feel as they win and lose.
Absolutely. All of our reporters this evening have been saying, even at our local Democratic and Republican headquarters, even with the extremity and the closeness of those races, those were put on the back burner. Everyone was paying attention to this race right here, the presidential race, and you see why now, because it came down to these final less than 1% of a vote that gave Bush the win in Florida and that gives Bush the win. He is our president-elect of the United States, our next president following Bill Clinton.
And once again, we go back to Dr. Steve Johnson, his Middletown survey, his claim that the city of Muncie can actually determine what the presidential election results will be. And he said that Bush would win by 8%. Sorry, Dr. Johnson, but that was not the case tonight. George W. Bush winning by the slimmest of margins, the closest margin since Kennedy and Nixon in 1960. You'll hear that repeated over and over again because that's exactly how close it was. We've been talking all night. Iowa, 600 votes at one time. Wisconsin, 6,000 votes. Oregon, 10,000 votes. These are the reasons that we have democracy and that we go to the polls, because nothing is taken for granted.
Oh, absolutely. And we look back at some of the states that were really important for Gore and Bush. We saw that Pennsylvania was important for both of these candidates. Gore took that one. New York was important for both of them, but really from the beginning it's appeared that Gore was going to take that one as well. Florida, as we now know, was the determining factor. Michigan and Illinois, which I do believe Gore took both of those as well. Ohio, it took us quite a while to get back returns on Ohio, but Bush did in fact end up winning there. Wisconsin, I'm not even for sure we still have returns from Wisconsin. You have the Nader factor to consider there. How important was Nader's effect in this campaign in Wisconsin and Oregon, even in other states where had Nader not been around, Gore may have gotten those votes that could have pushed him over the top, John?
Well, it's obvious that Nader did have an effect, although you may overstate his effect, because most of his votes came in those states like Oregon and Wisconsin that we see aren't having that much of an impact on the Electoral College. As far as the popular vote is concerned, we see that had the 2 or 3% that voted for Ralph Nader switch their voting, gone toward Al Gore, we could see a situation the reverse of what we were possibly expecting tonight. We possibly expected that Bush could win the popular vote, Gore win the electoral vote. Instead, if Nader's supporters had all voted for Gore, we could have seen things the other way around, where Bush now wins the electoral vote and Gore actually wins the popular vote, and we may have been right back to square one.
Right, and also with the Nader effect, it appears that it had no effect in California because Gore did still take California. There was lots of discussion that it could have had an effect, but as you said, Nader didn't even get the 5% that he needs to for the Green Party to get campaign financing in the future.
Of course, very important to note that those aren't final totals yet. Whether or not Oregon and Wisconsin, very strong states for Nader, will pull him up to 5%. Unlikely, maybe, but whether or not that is actually final, it's not quite safe to say that he will not get that federal funding during the next election cycle for the Green Party. But safe to say that it's unlikely that Wisconsin and Oregon, being relatively small states, will pull Nader over the 5% mark. Once again, there you see the electoral vote map. We've got mostly yellow. That, you know what that means. That means George W. Bush is the president-elect, the 44th president-to-be of the United States of America. There you see again the live shot via satellite from Austin, Texas, where George W. Bush should be giving his victory speech shortly. We may also have the concession speech from Al Gore from Nashville. We'll have to see what the time conflicts are on that. Obviously, both campaigns probably going to work those times out so that they don't conflict and people get to hear from both candidates. Only fair in this type of presidential election.
Right, and it's going to be interesting to see, John, what happens in these next 4 years, the first 4 years of Bush's presidency, to see whether or not his plan for Social Security follows through, where folks will be able to invest their Social Security monies into the stock market and whatnot, into their own private ways of investing. Also along the lines of education, to see whether Bush's not as high budget education plan holds up like he thinks it might.
And important to note, we've heard a lot of people saying, especially some younger voters saying, well, if this candidate wins, the candidate that I'm not supporting, if this candidate wins, I'm moving to Canada. That's a very extreme position to take, and I don't think it's very fair, because you have to have faith in the system that regardless of who's in office and who puts their policies into motion, that they're going to have, at least in most part, the best interest of the American people in mind, and that there won't be any need to move to Canada. That's sort of outlandish to think that. Although you may not like the person in office, you have to at least have a little faith that the system will work in the way it's supposed to.
Right, and as we were mentioning earlier, it appears Gore did take all the states that he needed except for that last crucial one in Florida, which we initially thought he had. But apparently not. Now we know that Bush has, in fact, taken that with help from his brother, the governor, Jeb Bush. We don't know yet at this point because we still really don't know what exactly put Bush over the top, what precincts, what areas of the state. But presumably it may have been the Miami areas. Traditionally, though, Democrats tend, minorities, which there are a lot of in Miami, tend to go for the Democrats. But I've also heard that minorities in Miami tend to go more toward the Republicans, and it's just minorities throughout the rest of the U.S. that tend to go Democrat. It'll be interesting to see the analysis of that.
Well, the minority population, especially in Miami and in southern Florida, is actually becoming rather affluent. Of course, you can't say that for the entire minority population, but there is a quite a large growing community of Cuban people in Miami, immigrants from Cuba, and people who are one or two generations removed from Cuban immigrants in Miami, who are actually doing very well for themselves. And of course, small business owners, people who generally do better in the socioeconomic scheme of things, tend to vote Republican. And that's something that maybe could have helped George W. Bush. Of course, all of this is mere speculation. Whether or not that was actually the case, we'll have to break it down precinct by precinct. And those numbers, of course, won't be available and broken down for at least days to come. And so we can always say what if, We can also always say, did this happen? Whether or not it actually did, though, Jared, is basically just guessing at this point.
Right, and some information here on the AP and also from ABC News on their websites. If these projections hold up and all these numbers are correct, Republicans will, for the first time since 1954, control the White House, the Senate, and the House of Representatives. So the House and Senate have been controlled by Republicans for a few years now, but the White House, of course, in Democratic hands.
And that is very important. That can't be understated. President Clinton, in a way, depending on which side you're on, was either holding the Republican Congress back from going through with their contract with America that they came in on in 1994, or he was keeping them in check, depending on which side you were on, from going into some of the things which they had proposed. The Republican Party generally favoring more of the business interests, keeping returning tax money to people and allowing people to use more of their own money at their own will. That's why George W. Bush's Social Security and Medicare plans have individuals making the decisions how to invest their money, whether or not to put it in HMOs. You see George W. Bush's supporters out there, all in Austin, Texas, still waiting for the word from George W. Bush when he's going to actually give his acceptance speech.
And you also have to think back, John, the Bush family has to be absolutely ecstatic because Clinton and the Democrats were the ones that took away the White House from the Republicans to begin with, from George W. Bush's father, President George Herbert Walker Bush. And so in a sense, the family has regained their title, their status.
Well, it's also, we've been talking about a victory for the party. You're right, it is a victory for the family. Not necessarily so much as revenge against President Clinton, but just some negative things happened during the first Bush years. We had the Persian Gulf War. We went into a fairly deep recession back in 1991 and into 1992, one of the main reasons why President Clinton was elected in the first place. And now it's sort of the same attitude, as we said earlier, kind of trying to get rid of the Clinton dynasty, more being upset with the people who are in office than favoring the people who are trying to gain that office.
Right, and you also have to think how much effect the Clinton administration had possibly on Gore losing this election. I don't really think it had so much because Gore kind of distanced himself from the Clinton administration, I guess you could say, running as his own man on his own policies, his own issues, although Clinton's administration, his policies did come up quite a bit, but Gore seems to have his own take on the policies of the Clinton-Gore administration.
And our analyst did is say just that. Of course, Al Gore in the beginning did try to say, I am not a part of the Clinton administration. I had nothing to do with Monica Lewinsky. I had nothing to do with Whitewater, etc. And yet at the same time, Al Gore said, look at the economy. We've done great things for the economy in the last 8 years. I've done something to help that. So it's been kind of a paradox for Al Gore trying to straddle that line between taking credit for some of the economic gains seen during the Clinton administration, but also trying to distance himself from what Clinton did in a moral sense.
Right, and there you see we're still in Austin, Texas with that live shot. Those folks anxiously awaiting comments from President-elect George W. Bush, possibly even Vice Presidential-elect Dick Cheney on hand for some comments possibly. We shall see on that shortly as folks are waiting there, sticking it out in the rain and the what looks to be some kind of bad conditions weather-wise. But we shall see shortly what kind of comments Bush has to make, of course, should Gore decide to make any comments in Nashville, Tennessee. We will cut to that as well.
And we don't have any official word on whether, on when exactly George W. Bush's campaign will announce their victory and George W. Bush will actually approach the podium. That is still not in our hands right now. We are hoping, against all hope, that it happens before 3 o'clock and we have to go off the air.
That's right.
We will try to bring that to you as best we can. Be sure that If we do not get it to you now, we will definitely get it to you tomorrow on NewsCenter at 5:30.
Most definitely. We are only on for another 15 minutes, so hopefully we get some kind of announcement here very soon. At least someone coming out to say the governor is on his way out, because we really haven't heard much of that either. And as I said, we'll go back to Nashville once we hear of any kind of speech being ready to be presented there. When we saw Nashville earlier, things looked fairly somber. People, of course, not really happy. Of course, those are the strong Gore supporters. Gore, although did not win in Tennessee, but he still does have his loyal fan base, his support base there, and that's where he's maintained his headquarters and his home for many years now.
We've been talking about polls all night, Jared. The tracking polls, which showed the race to be too close to call. The exit polls, which showed Gore had the lead in Florida. The poll in Muncie that said that Bush would win by 8%, which we found to not necessarily be the case. But one thing that the polls have shown us is that we can't trust the polls necessarily, because the polls really haven't told us much other than they can't tell us anything. It's kind of a conundrum, and it's something that obviously the pollsters themselves will have to watch out for, and also the media, by the fact that they called a race before it was actually a final result, obviously pertains to the fact that the media obviously made a mistake there in calling something a little too early before it actually happened. And that's why we're seeing the big turnaround tonight. The experts have said that Gore would get California, and that Gore would get New York, and that Gore would probably get Michigan. But they also said that Gore was a little bit ahead in Florida, and that's the one place and the most important place that they might have been wrong.
Right, and polls just as of yesterday morning, well, Monday morning rather, because we are into Wednesday now, the Zogby Reuters poll, which many classify and plug as probably the most accurate of the polls, showed Bush up by only 1 point. So if you go by that Zogby Reuters poll, that's fairly accurate. But a lot of the other polls, you know, the exit polls that we saw in Florida, really have to question their accuracy, as you mentioned.
Once again, you are watching live pictures from Austin, Texas, via satellite, where George W. Bush is preparing to make his acceptance speech. George W. Bush, likely to be elected the 43rd president of the United States. I have to correct myself. I said 44th earlier. I counted President Clinton twice in that, since he did have two terms. I apologize for that mistake. George W. Bush, likely the 43rd president of the United States. Of course, at the bottom of your screen, you're seeing our Election 2000 ticker. All of the results from all of the county races, as well as state and national races, all the important races for voters here in Delaware County, are rolling across the bottom of your screen as we speak. Of course, you can also see those results on our website. Go to www.bsu.edu/news. That's the homepage for the Ball State University News Center. And you can then find a link to our site where we'll have those election results for you for the rest of the night.
And of course, a Republican victory nationwide, but here locally, a Democratic victory as far as the county commissioners and the county council goes. You may want to check out those numbers just to see how close some of those were, and just to see who came out ahead in various precincts and whatnot.
And very split tickets. Statewide, we saw the balance of the congressional seats stay the same. Six Republicans and four Democrats going to the United States House of Representatives from Indiana. And, of course, Governor O'Bannon, the Democrat, being reelected. And the Attorney General Steve Carter with the upset over incumbent Karen Freeman Wilson. So a lot of mixed opinions here in Indiana. But the opinion of the nation has spoken, and they're saying George W. Bush should be the next president of the United States.
Absolutely. And I'll tell you what, John, we're getting worn out here trying to keep things going. We've been waiting all night for Florida, but have you seen those kids there? They've got little babies out there waiting also to hear. I can't imagine how tired those kids are.
They are definitely up past their bedtime. Of course, we are too. Going on 3 o'clock, we are going to do our best. The latest word says 10 minutes until George W. Bush gives his acceptance speech. We will do our best to get that, as much of that to you as we possibly can. That will be butting up right against our 3 o'clock deadline to get that information to you.
and we appreciate you sticking with us throughout the night. We've had lots of coverage this evening. We had coverage from Democratic headquarters in Indianapolis, also here in Muncie. We had coverage from Republican headquarters in Hotel Roberts in downtown Muncie. Kylie Gandolf was there. We had folks with Mike Pence, folks with Bob Rock. We also had Paige Lewis and Dustin Grove joining you from our election center with up-to-the-minute results. And we appreciate all their hard work this evening. They've put in a lot of work for us to get us all the interviews, all the necessary information. They've done an absolutely great job, John.
And that's absolutely right. And as I said before, even if we are not able to bring this to you live tonight, we will have a complete wrap-up, as I said before, tomorrow on News Center at 5:30 and 9:30 here on channels 57 and 43.
And we've had, of course, this coverage for you. We went on this tonight at 6 o'clock. This, I guess, is our eighth hour of coverage. We had intended to only stay on until 2 o'clock. We extended our coverage as we were waiting for Florida to come in. But we only have about 9 minutes left now, so hopefully we can get a little bit of George W. Bush, and we're still waiting for him. We still see lots of people. We're now down to 8 minutes and counting, it appears. And we're still waiting. Now we're in a holding pattern for a speech. It was that holding pattern for Florida. Now we're waiting for the governor, now president-elect George W. Bush, to make some kind of statement to the people. Of course, expressing his gratitude, we're sure his excitement and whatnot, because those folks have just been working tirelessly to get out the Bush name. I'm sure he's tired from all those cross-country trips. As you've seen on the news, we've been bringing you their various stops on all of our newscasts and showing you where they've been, hitting some of the big states lately, wondering whether or not those states would sway Democrat or Republican, Bush or Gore. And you see here, Florida was the determining factor. There were a lot of visits there in this, the past final days of the trip. Gore trying to appeal to the elderly and whatnot, promoting his Social Security, his Medicare plans, and Bush appealing more to the retired folks there, the ones who have the money, who support his brother Jeb Bush, who we assume did pull a lot of the support for George W.
And you are absolutely right when you said that these people here in Austin, Texas will rest much easier tonight,
oh, yeah.
The people working so hard. And I'll be completely honest, it feels a little bit like New Year's Eve right now, counting down until George W. Bush's acceptance speech. It's also like New Year's Eve in one other important way. I mentioned a little earlier, some people are really worried that George W. Bush, along with a Republican-controlled House and Senate, will come along and change a lot of things. But as we've seen, and as the polls say, when you go around and ask voters what they think the effect of a new president will be on their lives, a lot of people say that really, a new president doesn't have that much effect on their lives. So it's like New Year's Eve in the fact that when you wake up tomorrow, even though the calendar may be different, things still feel pretty much the same. And in January, once Bush would be inaugurated, the president may be different, but things would still feel pretty much the same.
Right, Winter, we are into our final 5 minutes here. And John, over the past couple years, of course, we've had the Monica Lewinsky scandal with the Clinton administration. A lot of split things in Washington. It's going to be really interesting to see how much more smoothly things will operate in Washington, how much work will actually get done, and not as much focus on scandals, that kind of stuff, because we've even seen here in the past week or so that there was some information that came out about Bush, about a DUI. Apparently that didn't really affect him that much.
Well, it's pretty apparent that that didn't affect him very much, and I think that whether or not it was actually information put out by the Gore campaign in order to discredit George W. Bush, whether or not that was true, I think the timing of it didn't really end up mattering in the long run. Maybe if it would have come out a little sooner, maybe it would have had more of an impact. A lot of absentee ballots were already cast. A lot of mail-in ballots were already cast. And so the all-in-all effect of that allegation and that information that came out in the last week leading up to Election Day, may not have as much of may not have had as much of an effect as was intended.
Right, and Bush really thought that that was going to have a huge effect on his campaign. Initially thought that possibly that leaked out through the Gore campaign, and that's how that was discovered. But of course, they can't be mad at this point because they have appeared to won the White House, and looks like all is well at this point. But of course, a reporter in a New England state, it has slipped my mind at this point, but she actually has came out and said it was me that dug up the information that heard this. Gore has nothing to do with it, so you still have to wonder.
That was actually in Maine, Jared,
Maine, right.
If I remember correctly. And the information itself was important in the fact that it was something that George W. Bush had done and that hadn't been released yet. And I think it's important for the American voters to know when things like that come out. But obviously it's left up to the American voters whether or not they're going to let that affect their vote. And apparently it didn't do that very much this election cycle. And whereas with the scandals that President Clinton went through, that may have hurt Al Gore.
Right. And Bush has said from the beginning he's being honest about his entire past. He has nothing to hide. Of course, there's been some questions that he's tried to dodge as far as his military experience, whether or not he kind of just laid back and stayed in the Texas Air National Guard or whatnot, you know, really didn't get involved in Vietnam and those kinds of issues. But, you know, you still have to wonder, you know, how honest are the candidates being, because there's surely things that, you know, you really don't want to say about yourself, but that really probably don't have much of an impact anyway.
There will always be those doubts and those questions. There were when President Clinton took office 8 years ago. We heard doubts about President Clinton's use of marijuana. We heard doubts about President Clinton dodging the draft.
Right.
So those things will linger around for George W. Bush. What's going to be the big test for him, even though he does have a Republican majority in the House and the Senate, is whether or not he'll actually be able to reach across party lines.
Right.
The only way to get things done in Washington is by reaching a consensus and having a coalition of people who can push your agenda through the Congress and make it into law. And although there is a Republican majority, if there's too much bickering between the parties, it's difficult to say whether or not any of that will actually be truly effective.
And in Texas, Governor Bush has said that he has reached across those party lines, that he's done some great communicating there, being able to get some things done. So it'll be interesting to see if he's able to do the same thing at in D.C. and really getting things done. We know he has lots of issues, lots of things that he wants to tackle, especially in these first 4 years. It'll be interesting to see how the Democrats take it, because it is still a very close split, but the Republicans do still have control in that House and the Senate.
And our countdown is down to about 2 minutes until that ball drops and George W. Bush makes his way out onto the stage to walk to the podium and give his speech announcing that he will become the next president of the United States of America. You see an anxious crowd in Austin, Texas. They're in the Texas Capitol, where George W. Bush has been the governor for the past couple of years. He is getting ready to make his speech. You see the stage there where the podium is, where George W. Bush will reach out and thank all of his supporters. I'm sure we heard Hillary Clinton list a lot of supporters.
A lot, yes.
We heard local candidates also thank a lot of people. That's normal. Whether or not Bush will thank a litany of people or just give us some general remarks, we don't know. Chances are he's had his speech written for a long time now.
Oh, sure. And of course, we won't be able to bring the speech to you as we're down into our final seconds, it appears, of our Election 2000 coverage. We appreciate you sticking with us. Be sure to tune in tomorrow for NewsCenter at 5:30 and 9:30. We will have a complete wrap of all of Election Day's events, including an acceptance speech and a concession speech by George W. Bush and Al Gore. It'll be interesting to see what they have to say and what they kind of credit their win and their loss to, per se.
Once again, the new president of the United States, elected by the American people, George W. Bush and Dick Cheney, the vice president. That is all for you from here, our Election 2000 special, and good night.
Who cares? We got the ending on tape.
Yeah, we got it on tape.